Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the April 25th meeting of the Planning Board. Let's see, let's start with going around the table.
Hardin Welsh.
Bob Brown.
Michael Barrett, Town Planner. And several people cannot make it tonight. Paul Rasmussen, Nathaniel Morneau, and Sally Tobias.
Barbara Dill, and I am not the Chair of the Planning Board, but I am sitting in for Paul, who's away this week.
Bill McGowan.
Lauren Parnell.
So, first up, does anyone want to, Michael, you had talked a little bit about rearranging some of the agenda.
Well, we do really want to get through the whole agenda tonight, if we can, because we don't like to postpone or cancel or push people back. But as you know, the Planning Board has a policy that no new items are taken up after 10 o'clock unless there's a two-thirds vote to do so. But hopefully, we will not come down to that. The only thing you might think about is the solar energy public hearing may take a while. And we have three applications after that for Colony Cove, Cedar Point Road, and Packers Falls Road. And there may well be some issues and questions with those. But if time is tight, the board might consider just setting the public hearing for those for May 9th and delaying much discussion. So if it looks like the solar energy is going to take a while, you could move those up in front of it.
Does anybody have any thoughts on that?
I think we should go with the agendas we have and see what happens.
I would support that as well at this point. Let's drive through.
We normally hold public hearings at the beginning, so I think we should go ahead with that system.
Okay.
We have to stay later. We have to stay later.
Okay. It's okay with me.
So I make a motion to approve the agenda as printed out tonight.
Thank you.
Second that.
All in favor?
Aye.
So first up, I'm sorry. Do you have a town planner's report?
Only that for our next meeting is in 2 weeks on May 9th, and that's the annual meeting of the Planning Board, and all that means is that you elect your officers for the year and appoint people to the various town boards and committees. And then the following meeting on May 23rd is the workshop, at which time we do not discuss applications, but discuss general planning issues. That's it.
Do we have any reports from board members who serve on other committees? Hardin.
Yes. From the town council, we've met once since our last meeting. Two things I think of note. One was the committee. At the meeting, Barbara Dill was reappointed to a three-year term. James Bubar was appointed to a three-year term. Michael Lambert was appointed to a three-year term as an alternate. And Bill McGowan was asked to come before the council, really, I think, to determine his availability because he missed 40% of the meetings over a period of time, according to the information we had from the chairman. And so the New Hampshire State Planning Board handbook says members should try and make 80 to 85% of the meetings. So we want to speak with him about that. The second thing was that the Planning Board initiated zoning to add freeboard and address sea level rise was adopted by the council. Those are the two.
Anyone else? So next we would have public comments about anything that's not on tonight's agenda that people would like to discuss. So I guess there aren't any public comments tonight. So, fortunately, we don't have any minutes to review, right? So, first up, we have Bella's Ice Cream, a proposal by Tom Foote, proprietor of Bella's Restaurant in the Mill Plaza, to renovate the open shelter in front of the restaurant for use as an ice cream stand. Designed by Walter Rouse, architect, map 5, lot 1-1, Central Business District. So, are you going to, is Mr. Foote here?
Mm-hmm. Yes, I am. Hi, members of the board. My name is Thomas Foote. This is my wife, Jeannie.
Hello.
And we own Bella's. And first, before we get into anything, I'd like to say thank you very much to y'all for supporting us and everybody else that's here, too. It's been a great 6 years, by the way. Another thing that we really liked about being in Durham was Kaleidoscope. I think Kaleidoscope was a great, great thing for especially the strip mall down there. You know, there's a lot of people that used to come down to Kaleidoscope, and we saw a lot of families. And the same thing happens with Bella's. Since we've created Bella's, we've created for the locals, and we get a lot of families. And I think with all those families that are coming down, that came down for Kaleidoscope, and they'll come back and come down for Bella's, it's just kind of like a no-brainer. Let's just kind of combine them, and then we'll have the best of both worlds. So what we'd like to do is create an ice cream stand outside, out front of Bella's. We already have it's like a pergola, and we're currently using it to serve food out there now. So what we'd like to do is enclose half of the pergola, because we can't sell ice cream outside without having walls. It has to be enclosed. It has to have water, and it has to have, of course, electricity and stuff like that. So what we'd like to do is enclose that, just add four walls to it. It's already existing. We're already using it to serve stuff. Just add four walls to it, and then a door, a couple windows, make it look cute, and then open it up and sell ice cream. I believe the plans, y'all have a copy of the plans? Good. If you look at the plans, not the one with the cows, so that's really cool. The top of it, the top half shows the four walls, it shows the whole pergola. There's two sections to it. The left side is the wraparound bench that we propose to build on that side. That's going to be the focal point for, you know, everybody gets their ice cream, they go sit over there. We also have seating around the side of the building too that people can use. The right side shows the floor plan of the inside of the little ice cream stand we're going to build there. And then the two service windows and the door. Now, as you look at the two service windows and the door, if you're standing inside Bella's looking outside front windows, that's what you'll see. You'll see the door and the two service windows. What we plan on doing is, if you're inside Bella's and looking outside, the window to the right, that would be the ordering window, and the people would line up going down the sidewalk. Okay, that's something that Kaleidoscope didn't do. When they were really, really, really busy, the lines were so long, they'd be going right into the parking lot, kind of like right in the way of the cars. So what we're trying to do is keep everybody safe and just keep them all on the sidewalk and keep them out of the traffic. The middle window, that's for pickup, and then they can either go over to the seating area and hang out there, or if they want, they can go around the corner out to our side patio. We're just going to run some electricity in there to run all the parts. We run water through the ceiling, across our dining room, down into the building right here. And we're also going to do a sump pump, which is going to pump the water back up into the ceiling, back into Bella's, and dump it out back into our mop drain. So as far as getting all this stuff, putting it up, it goes pretty quick, I'm hoping. It's pretty simple for us to run the power to it and everything else. at least in my mind. We'll find out. But this whole thing, time is very critical. If we don't start first thing in January, the first week of January, end of May, gives us 16 weeks to do this. The amount of money it's going to cost me to build this thing is going to be, and run it, is going to be, I'll be lucky to break even in 16 weeks. Now, I know you might be thinking, well, what about next year when this is all up? I think about that too. What about next year? I know my lease ends up the end of May next year. So I don't know what happens next year. So we would like to do this. Time is critical. And I think it would be really cool for the town. We'd enjoy it. I think the town would enjoy it. But we got to do it quick.
Does anyone have questions of Mr. Foote?
You mean, really mean January?
Sorry?
Did you really mean January?
Oh, did I say January?
Yeah.
I meant June.
Okay.
June 1. Sorry. A little nervous. I flunked public speaking. I never went.
So this is the same size as what currently exists?
It's exactly the same thing.
Jeannie, it doesn't bother you that the view is going to be blocked a bit from inside the restaurant?
No, not really. I thought about that, and for me, like he said, the amount of families that we get down there, I think it would be so cool. You know, as it is right now, we have the parents that come in, and when they had Kaleidoscope, they'd send the kids over, and they'd all come back, and we don't have that now. We lost a bit of the community. So I think, you know, seeing the kids out there waiting in line, I love it.
And they'll be allowed then to sit on the side?
Sure.
The side area.
Sure.
Good. Thanks.
Yeah.
Good.
You have, at the present time, you have tables in this area, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Where will those people eat that are sitting there now? Where will they go after this is?
So we have a side patio. Right. We're licensed for 72 outside. And as it is right now, we only have, the seating we have only puts 54.
Yeah, if it's
so
that
we
much.
Can move those tables on our side patio and still be licensed for that capacity.
Yeah.
Is there issues there with respect to the parking lot? And,
No. We have a full patio that fits.
Yeah. Okay.
We have four picnic tables on it right now.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, in the wintertime, we have five cars on the patio.
Okay. I was here when we approved the Kaleidoscope, which did have to go through a site plan review, in fact, to do that one. And one of the issues that we had at the time, which turned out to be an issue that had to be dealt with, was people, as you say, lining up onto the parking lot, in effect, or onto what is really a road.
Yeah.
And I think that when I first saw this, I wasn't sure how this was oriented, and I wasn't sure whether the people would be lining up in the parking lot or lining up on the sidewalk. But I think that since they're lining up on the sidewalk, that takes care of one issue that we would have with this. But beyond that, I don't see too much.
Would you put up a fence or some sort of, just to make sure they line up that way? Or a portable, not something permanent, but just something so they would know to line up that way.
Yeah, we could easily do that.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
You can buy those things.
Rope and some posts. Yeah.
Yeah. Just
portable stuff.
Yeah. That's easy.
Yeah.
I have a couple questions about Walter's cows. I really love them. I think they're great, and they just go to show how much nicer doing things by hand is than digital cows, because if they were digital, they'd probably be two different kinds of cows that would alternate, and they wouldn't have personalities like these do. And I love the one that's got his tail curled around the ice cream cone. But what I was wondering is, I have friends who don't eat dairy for one reason or another. Will you be serving other than dairy type regular ice cream?
I'll be honest, I'm just trying to get ice cream right now.
Okay.
Well, but the real answer is yes. We're gonna go for everything. So we'll be doing sherbet, anything that you get at the dairy bar, we'll get over here.
Yeah, of course.
Because I'm sure he could find a way to make a vegan cow.
I'm sure we, there's got to be.
Vegan cow.
What are we supposed to be doing with this, Michael?
Well, because our site plan regulations are a little vague, there's a judgment whether this requires review at all. And I think that it would be a very reasonable judgment that it does not require formal site plan review.
Could you just explain why that is?
Yeah, I mean, because the way our site plan regulations simply say site plan review is required for development, which is defined as any man-made change to improved or unimproved land, including but not limited to changes to buildings or other structures, and then other things that are not relevant, including significant change of use. So given that the structure is already there and it has a roof and it is accessory to the existing business and people do dine in there, that it seems to partially enclose the right side, make some changes around, some aesthetic changes to the exterior, and then bring in the food service there, particularly since there's a good chance that this would only be short term. I think it would be reasonable to see this as falling below that threshold of development. But there's actually three levels. You know, you could find it not subject to review, which I think is reasonable. But if you do that, we would have the staff meet on site, and we would just look at the electric and water and sewer service and access and just, you know, make sure there's no issues. You could also do this as a minor site review, which is a little quicker, but it involves all the fees and notices and public hearings and is a little burdensome. Or you could have it come to the planning board, which, again, requires all the fees and notices. And I know that the property owner is hoping to get moving in early May.
What do you recommend, Michael?
I mean, I recommend a determination that it's not subject to review, but we would have a staff meeting with fire, police, public works, economic development, building, and planning to make sure that, and they're really mainly building type issues, make sure that the electric, the water, and the sewer, as well as access, is fine. And as part of that, we probably, you know, would want a final design of the cows so we just know what that's going to look like. That would be it.
So what do we need this evening?
Just to give me direction how you want to handle it.
Motion?
Yeah, that'd be good.
All right, I'll make a motion to have this application as not subject to review.
I'll second that.
All in favor?
Aye.
Unanimous.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Have a good night.
We'll send you a note and arrange an on-site meeting with it.
That'd be awesome.
Perfect. Thank you very much.
Thanks.
So, next we have public hearing for 100 Mill Road, a conditional use for driveway. This is a proposal to install a driveway and utilities within the Wetland Conservation Overlay District for a new single-family house. Linda Stockson and Louis Tisa, property owners. Chris Berry, surveyor agent. Map 13, lot 15-3, RB District. Is the applicant here? Yes.
Madam Chair, members of the board, Christopher Berry with Berry Surveying and Engineering. We've recently done a site walk out at 100 Mill Road so that the board could see the extents of the proposed driveway. Just a quick recap for those that weren't present. We're proposing a 12-foot wide driveway in the pretty much the exact same location that was previously approved as part of a subdivision 5 or 6 years ago. And now that lot is proposed to be constructed on by Linda and Lou. And so we're moving through the conditional use permit process At the site walk, we discussed the overall width, general proximity to the jurisdictional wetlands that have been redelineated as of last fall, and some sediment erosion control features that would be proposed on site to limit the amount of disturbance to take place and to increase the amount of overland flow between the impervious surface and the jurisdictional wetlands. So with that, I know that the applicants have stood before the board before. I believe that they've gone to the Conservation Commission and have received a favorable response there. So I'm simply here to answer any technical questions that you might have, and the applicants are here also if there are further questions that I can't answer.
Does anyone have questions?
But we do have to open the public hearing.
Oh, I'm sorry. Right? I forgot to open the public hearing. So I make a motion to open the public hearing. Am I allowed to make that motion?
Yep. Okay. Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
I'll make a motion to close the public hearing.
Well, you have to ask if anyone wants to.
Well, I did that already.
Oh.
No.
They might have, I'm not sure everybody heard.
Okay. Does anybody want to ask a question?
Or make a comment?
We have to invite the public
yes.
to speak.
Yes. Okay. Sorry. Anyone from the public? Anyone from the board?
I'll make a motion to close the public hearing.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. I'd like to make a comment about this. I'm not sure whether everyone realizes that since this is a conditional use application, and we only have five members here, a conditional use demands that it's accepted by five board members. So it would have to be a unanimous vote. And if we if it isn't unanimous, if it's 4-1 with somebody against it, then this application would be rejected and they would have to, wouldn't be?
No. I mean, to approve this tonight would require a unanimous vote of all five members. But if it were to be voted favorably by, say, 4-1, then the approval would fail and it would then, unless you voted to deny it, then it would most likely just be continued to the next meeting, in which case we likely would have more than five people here.
You're sure that's what would happen?
Yeah. Yeah, because if there's not actually a vote to deny, then there's no action.
I was going to suggest that
there's no action taken.
I would just suggest that if this was my project, I would rather have seven members here and take my chances with seven members than with having to require. But if it will just mean it's postpone to the next meeting, then that's fine.
Yeah, I mean, let's say there's a vote of 4-1 to approve it, then the conditional use fails, and without a vote, say 3-2 to deny it, it's in limbo. So it would just continue on until there's a final vote to approve with at least five or to deny.
Yeah, because I think a member voting in favor can ask to reopen it or revote.
Yeah, I don't even think you would need to, because without a vote to deny, it would just be in limbo and continue to the next meeting. Yeah.
Okay, then we can proceed.
So this is a good question.
Or yeah. We want to proceed.
It is a good question. Are we ready to vote?
Well, and they have the they addressed the both the eight general criteria, which don't have a lot of relevance to with the wetland overlay, but some, and then more importantly, the four specific criteria in the wetland conservation overlay district.
Do we have to go over those?
No, you don't have to go through the four specific unless there's particular questions or concerns. And we have the checklist, which we can run through quickly. Most of it will not be applicable.
Do you have a copy of the checklist?
Yeah. So, but if there's any other questions about how the four specific criteria are addressed in terms of erosion control, minimizing impacts on the wetlands, which Mr. Berry might be able to address if you have particular questions about that. Well, I mean, was there anything that you wanted to add?
No, only that when we talked on the sidewalk, there was some, just some general discussion about siltation controls. So I did prepare for tonight's meeting just some construction details, because it seemed as though that seemed to be the focus of the...
So all we've done is just prepare a brief temporary erosion control measure form. It discusses how the applicant intends to construct the site, and then two chosen sediment erosion control features, which are the sediment socks or silt socks, and then the mulch berm.
We found that these are far superior in use than the classic silt fence. And so I noted that a few of the board members along the sidewalk had questions concerning that and proximity to wetlands. So when I got back to the office this afternoon, I just simply prepared a couple of cut sheets so that you would have something to view this evening and something to view the file, so that you knew how the applicant intended to build the site out. Though they do speak specifically to a few of these items within the four or five criteria that Michael's pointed out. But I really have nothing new to add. If there are any board members that don't feel as though we've answered their questions and can't vote favorably this evening on this, you know, I'd like to hear that those questions so that I might be able to respond. But
yeah, it looks good. I mean, so we could just, you could incorporate this into the prospective approval reference to this.
All right. All right, so can I have a motion to...
I'll make a motion that we... approve the conditional use for driveway and utilities at 100 Mill Road, according to the notice of decision that we have in front of us this evening. As delineated in the map with on that notice of decision.
Second.
Yeah, Madam Chair, before you vote, do you, I mean, you can't usually go through the conditional use list. Probably should do that.
Okay.
I think it's fairly straightforward. The other thing, before you do that, I would suggest that adding to the conditions that to include reference to the temporary erosion control measures submitted by Barry Surveying tonight, with a reference on the conditions. And the question arose, I mean, we have draft conditions that say, the access point may be located where shown on the approved subdivision plans, may also be located anywhere further from the wetland if approved by the town engineer. And then we have the main driveway, which will come off the access point, may extend straight back from the to the buildable area. And this approval covers the driveway, necessary grading and drainage, underground electric, and any other utilities. So I think that covers it, unless you wanted to make the language more specific per the sidewalk about distance from the property line, or is this sufficient? This may be sufficient as written.
I've made my motion based on this.
Okay, but that includes this language.
I know.
Can we include the reference to temporary erosion control?
Sure.
Would that be number five?
Yes.
So we can run through these now?
Yeah.
Okay. Was the application made by the owner of the affected party or his or her designated agent on a form obtainable from the zoning administrator? Yes.
Yes.
Was the completed application and fee submitted to the zoning administrator or his or her designee? Yes.
Yes.
Was the public notice placed in the newspaper at least 10 days prior to the public hearing of the planning board?
Yes.
Were notices, written notices sent by certified mail to abutters within 300 feet of the subject property at
yes.
least 10 days?
Yes.
Was a sign measuring 2 by 3 feet placed on the property at least 10 days prior?
Yes.
Site suitability, is it suitable? Yes, 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 yes?
That's up to you all.
It's to me.
Yes.
Yes, yes.
External impacts, are the external impacts of the proposed use on abutting properties and the neighborhood greater than the impacts of the adjacent existing uses or other uses permitted in the zone?
No.
No?
No.
Character of the site development, will the proposed layout or design of the site be compatible with the established character of the neighborhood and shall mitigate any external impacts of use on the neighborhood?
Yes.
Yes.
Character of buildings and structures, is the design of any new buildings or structures and the modification of, what is that? Including everything? Yes?
MA.
Yeah, not applicable.
Do we have to continue with all this stuff on the back? Somewhere we...
Oh, you don't have to go through each line, you can just do the main thing.
Okay. If present, are the natural, cultural, historic, and scenic resources preserved?
Yes.
Impact on property values, will the proposed use cause or contribute to a significant decline in property values of adjacent properties? Availability of public service and facilities, have adequate and lawful facilities or arrangements been made for sewage disposal, solid waste disposal, water supply, utilities, drainage, and other necessary public or private services?
Yes.
Will these services cause excessive demand on municipal services, including but not limited to water, sewer, waste disposal, police protection, fire protection, and schools?
No.
Will the proposed use have a negative fiscal impact on the town?
No.
No.
And you don't have to go through that.
Okay, good. So...
Okay, I've made my motion based on this notice of decision in front of us with the addition of a comment on temporary erosion control measures presented to us this evening.
Do we have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
You want that?
Thank you for everybody's time this evening.
So now, what's next?
Solar
energy systems, proposed amendments to the zoning ordinance to accommodate solar energy systems as both accessory uses and principal uses. Draft ordinance has been endorsed by the Durham Energy Committee. So, shall we open the public hearing?
Well, let's want to see if any board members have any initial comments.
Do you?
What was the question?
Well, do you have any comments before we open the public hearing?
No, but we can make comments after, right?
Yes. Does anyone want to make a motion to open the public hearing?
I move we open the public hearing.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
So I'd like to ask the speakers to be sure not to refer to any existing solar energy systems by name of owner or address in this meeting, because we're talking now about how to regulate solar arrays for the future. So I would appreciate that. So who's first?
Good evening. Nancy Sandberg, 15 Langley Road. I have the honor this evening of coming before you because I have a letter from 70 residents who are concerned about this issue, and I would like to read it. I'm not going to read all the names, but I have copies for all members of the planning board. But what's significant about the 70 members is they come from various zones in the town, not from just one particular area. Dear members of the Durham Planning Board, we want to express our appreciation to the Durham Energy Subcommittee for taking on the difficult task and much-needed task of creating a Durham solar ordinance. We observe this summer the outcome of what can happen when a town does not have such an ordinance in place. We all support the use of solar energy. We also care deeply about maintaining the scenic quality of our community and its roadways, as well as the character of our neighborhoods. We believe both can and should be able to coexist through the careful consideration of both objectives. Thus, we were pleased to see in the purpose statement of the proposed solar ordinance, quote, promote environmental sustainability while protecting the character of rural and scenic lands and the use of productive agricultural lands, unquote. However, the proposed solar ordinance falls short of meeting this purpose statement. We are particularly concerned about the actual visual impact of the proposed ordinance along our designated scenic roads and our gateways, regardless of whether a freestanding solar system falls within our residential or commercial zones. From an aesthetic perspective, the use of a freestanding solar system should be evaluated site by site based on what is seen from the road versus what zone it happens to be in. A freestanding solar array along Packers Falls Road in the rural zone diminishes the scenic rural character just as much as a freestanding solar array along Mass Road, zoned Orly, Route 4, zoned both RC and the Durham Business Park, or Route 108, zoned RB. We urge you to review every aspect of the proposed ordinance, visualizing the actual impact on Durham's pastoral viewscapes, no matter what zone they fall within, and with consideration to permitted scale and height, because one size does not fit all. When it comes to the placement of freestanding solar systems on individual Durham properties, we urge you to replace the P's permitted by right with capital SE special exception, unless it's in backyards or behind buildings. This would allow for each unique situation to be reviewed individually by the zoning board and with the benefit of a community conversation. We also believe that height and setback regulations should be revisited again with an eye of how such a system will appear from the road. We urge the planning board to ensure that the solar ordinance that is adopted meets the purpose statement stated above by the drafters, one that truly reflects balance between two equally worthy objectives. And I will like to pass on the letter. And if you could be sure that the members who are not here this evening could get that.
Right.
Thank you.
Yep.
Are there any questions of me for now? Did this get scanned?
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank
Good evening. My name is Andrea Bodo. I'm on the Historic District Commission, but I'm here as myself tonight. I live at 20 New Market Road. I'd like to thank you on tackling the solar ordinance. I think that is something that we need as we move forward. I was struck when I was reading the ordinance that the purpose didn't seem strong enough to me. So I've taken the liberty to make some recommendations of some language for you. The sheet that I just gave you, your ordinance is in black and my suggestions are in blue. The first ordinance number is letter is A, to encourage the transition to renewable energy sources in accordance with the recommendations stated in the energy chapter of the Durham Master Plan. I would like to see encourage the transition to renewable energy sources while maintaining Durham scenic vistas in accordance with the recommendations stated in the energy chapter of the Durham Master Plan. The next one, B, it says promote environmental sustainability while protecting the character of rural and scenic lands and the use of productive agricultural lands. I'm proposing promote environmental sustainability while protecting the rural community character as seen from the public roads. I'm not quite sure what a productive agricultural land means, so I leave that up to you. But to me, I don't know if I would know what a productive agricultural land was unless there was a cow on it or something. And then for C, I think that we need to have a stronger impact. So I inserted minimize potential adverse impacts of solar energy systems in the community by ensuring that such facilities are properly screened and are properly sited within the existing topographic features of the property. And I think that's a really important purpose. And then D, to ensure the safety and maintenance procedures are in place to protect the public health. I did some research on this, and I guess there's a maintenance plan for these, or the requirements for these. And I don't know if they catch fire, or if the house was on fire, and the solar panels were on top, if they could catch fire. But I inserted that, because I think it's really important to protect the public health. And then changing C, I moved it down to be E, to comply with and support the state of New Hampshire's goals of developing clean, safe, renewable energy resources as provided for in the statutes referred to in number one above. And then my last request, or recommendation, I should say, on page 7, the third paragraph down where it says historic district, proposed solar energy systems within the Durham Historic District are regulated under Article 17 of this ordinance. I interpreted that to be the solar ordinance. Can it say in the zoning ordinance or in the town's ordinance or something? Whatever the formal name is of Chapter 17.
Okay. Yeah, that's the Historic District ordinance.
Yeah. Okay. I would recommend being specific on that, because when I was reading through this, it looks like would be in here. So those are my recommendations. Thank you for indulging me. Any questions? Thanks.
Good evening. I'm Judith Spang. I'm from 55 Wiswall Road. And I am also your state representative. And as such, I was asked to take a look at our state RSAs, our state statutes, to see how we are doing relative to developing an ordinance that may or may not conflict with state regulations. I think that the Section 672.1 was something that caused some anxiety, because it's something that specifically, and this happens a number of places in the statutes, to encourage the development of solar energy. There is a phrase in there that says, in part, "The installation of solar or other renewable energy systems shall not be unreasonably limited by the use of municipal zoning powers or by the unreasonable interpretation of such powers, except to protect public health, safety, and welfare." So this would seem to threaten to circumscribe what a municipality can do in terms of making it difficult for somebody to establish a solar installation. I frequently run up against this this phrase reasonable or unreasonable. For example, we run into it when we're talking about wetland things, what either technically feasible or unreasonable, et cetera. So I contacted an attorney from the New Hampshire Municipal Association and asked him what he thought of this regulation. What he said, and I think that Michael was pretty attentive in terms of sending this to you, but for the benefit of the public, I'll read it to you. He said, "The statute that you cited is pretty general and subjective. Clearly, it does leave room for the town to regulate solar as long as it does not do so unreasonably, only a test of reasonableness." So this becomes then, it leaves us, and particularly, you know, whether we're doing it as a building inspector or whether we're doing it as a special exception or whatever, to get into the murky land of what is reasonable and what is not. Is it reasonable to require that somebody jump through hoops to get a conditional use permit or a special exception? I also think, ask myself, what is reasonable in terms of what the private property owner should be expecting versus his property rights versus his obligation to the community in general? Does a solar installation need to maximize the amount of energy that comes out of that array, particularly if it had relative to the negative impacts that it might have? And in my mind, this has a lot to do not only with the location, but also with the size of the installation. I called the town of the planner from the town of Hampton because in 2009 they brought in a solar ordinance. And I think you'll be a little bit shocked. If we're thinking that ours is too strict, you'll be really shocked at what they have done. I won't use the phrase gotten away with because I don't think it's been tested in court. They say that there shall be no ground-mounted solar facilities over 2 square feet in a front yard. None. In a side or rear yard, it has to be fully screened. And at no panels anywhere on the site can be higher than 8 feet tall. So that's what they are considering to be reasonable. And apparently the state of New Hampshire decided that that was also reasonable. It's saying, yes, you can have them, but you can't have them too high, you can't have them in the wrong place. As an ex-planner and certainly as a legislator, when I'm considering zoning ordinances and municipal regulations, I go back to the purposes of the zoning ordinance in 674.17, which says, "Every zoning ordinance shall be made with reasonable consideration to, among other things, the character of the area involved and its peculiar suitability for particular uses, as well as with a view to conserving the value of buildings and encouraging the most appropriate use of land throughout the municipality." It gets to the whole issue of the impact on the rest of the community and the abutters' property values and that. I think there's a couple of questions that I would like to see investigated while we're considering this. The screening issue, I think, is something that we need to deal with. I was going down Packers Falls Road today, and I noticed that the backside of an array has a very different look to it than the front side of an array. The front side of an array makes you feel all warm and fuzzy. Here's our renewable energy. The back side looks very industrial and not unlike an unfortunate billboard. I also was a little bit mystified about how we are going to look at solar easements, and they are also enabled in the state RSAs. How do they affect the subsequent landowners? If the easement says the abutter can't put in anything that's going to block the sun, can they plant trees? And then a subsequent landowner, is he then going to not be able to plant trees? So I think that that's something that one of the many questions that we need to look at. And I certainly endorse what Nancy said about that we must be talking about site-specific. Everyone who is either pro-solar or anti-solar, if there is such a thing, can think of a site, a particular yard, where something works and something's going to be atrocious. And I think that we need to give ourselves the flexibility to be able to make sure that the installation that's being proposed is going to work in that particular location. As an ex-planner, I always think that there are no good uses and there are only bad uses. There are only uses that are put in the wrong place and in the wrong way. So I'll leave you with that, along with my assurance that we have solar panels on our house, and I certainly am in favor of them. I just want to see them done right, because then we can have a town full of these things because no one objects to them. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Can I ask the question?
Yes.
Thank you for that, Janet. Why do you bring
Judith.
Up, Judith.
Everyone calls me Janet.
Why do you bring up the impact on the abutter's ability to plant trees? I don't recognize that in here.
I put this in terms of a question, because I'm not exactly sure how solar easements work. I read the RSAs, and it seems to be an agreement between the landowner who has a solar array and possibly the abutter who is selling his right to block or not block the sun for that person, the landowner with the solar array. But I'm just raising it as a question because I've never heard of it before, and I just think it would be an interesting thing to think about if we're going to include that in our ordinance.
Okay, thank you.
Okay.
Thank you for getting that information and calling the attorney. I know I had some questions this morning in reading some of this and said, whoa, that's certainly an important point that we need to take a look at. So thank you for doing that.
I have more contact with the municipal association lawyer than sometimes I want to. Thank you very much.
Okay, I'm Janet. And my sister is Judy, so I get that all the time. Okay, I'm Janet Fredos. I'm off of Pacas Falls Road. I live on Little John Road, and I'm off Pacas Falls Road, and this is a statement I'd like to say. I'm very happy to see a lot more people are here to talk about solar zoning ordinance, because when I read that you were going to have a hearing for it, I wanted to come and give my two cents. I support having a solar zoning ordinance for visual site approval. How solar panels are placed on property affects the aesthetic appearance of the neighborhood. It is great to have solar energy, but the visual effect of the tracker or panel should be considered. If it doesn't conform to the visual appearance of the surrounding area, there should be a public hearing. I'm sure a solution would be met. And that's what I would like to say.
Thank you.
Any questions? No?
Thank you.
Good evening. My name's Diana Carroll, and I'll sit here. It's a little bit easier to read from the computer. I wanted to read the letter sent to you all by Peter Stanhope, who's a resident of Durham, lives at 37 Dover Road, and many of you know that he has served on many different, he's served on the council and all kinds of commissions and committees for many years, and he's also an appraiser by profession, so he has that background. Dear members of the Planning Board, I am in the last few days of my two terms on the Historic District Commission, Heritage Commission, but cannot miss the opportunity to opine on the proposed solar ordinance as a Heritage Commission member. Solar arrays on roofs for the purpose of providing domestic use power are a reasonable exercise of private property rights, and I support that right. Solar arrays populating portions of any site not affixed to the principal structure should conform to the use zone regulations. An array that has the capacity to generate marketable power is an industrial use and should be tested by an approval process that balances preservation of uses permitted in the zone. By example, a large visible array has the potential of diminishing property values. I cite the failure of Northern Pass to gain approval for this very reason. If the Planning Board finds some level of solar use outside commercial and industrial zones appropriate there as a minimum, should be a strict vegetation barrier screening, protecting the environment nearby from visual pollution from a non-conforming structure. This is a challenging issue, but just as wind farms, dams, and even offshore drilling are often part of this discussion, I encourage the Planning Board to listen carefully to all voices on this issue and not simply narrow the discussion to the agenda. Thank you for your consideration of these thoughts. Peter Stanhope.
Good evening. Robin Mower, Faculty Road. I'd like, if I may, first read a note to the Planning Board from John Perry, who is not able to be here tonight, and then I'd like to make my own comments, if I may. So John Perry, as you probably remember, was chair of the Conservation Commission. He is by profession an urban forester working for the United States Department of Agriculture, the Forestry Service. And he has spoken to the Planning Board in the past about ways to protect our very important asset, urban trees. He writes, I support the suggested requirement to have solar permitted by special exception. Requiring a zoning board review for each site would ensure that these are not placed where they have a detrimental effect on scenic views, land values, or the environment. I also have an additional concern about the increased use and placement of solar. I work as an urban forester for a government agency and provide assistance to communities in the New England states and New York. We are seeing more and more cases where large yard trees are being removed to provide full sun exposure for solar panels. I recall a permit that came before the Durham Conservation Commission requesting to remove trees in a wetland setback in order to accommodate solar panels. In some cases, the companies that work with solar aggressively promote the removal of trees to increase their output. This can become a contentious issue, especially in cases where the tree is on a neighbor's property and existed decades before the solar panel. Trees provide significant value in reducing energy consumption by shading buildings in summer and providing windbreaks in winter. This is a holistic and low-cost approach to energy conservation and provides a reduction in burning fossil fuels. Unlike solar panels, large trees around homes also provide many other benefits, such as improved air quality, stormwater management, and increased property value. Trees benefit not just the owner's home, but the neighborhood as well. I feel a solar ordinance should include language to balance the use of solar with the protection of trees, and hope that you will consider adding this language to the ordinance. I'm going to abbreviate my own comments, but provide written comments to you. First, I would like to commend the Energy Committee for continuing to work toward a bold vision, and the Planning Board for its cooperation in helping to move Durham along the path to greater energy sustainability. We have come a long way since Election Day, March 13, 2007, when Durham voters voted 1447 to 254 to adopt the New Hampshire Climate Change Resolution. I'm not going to address the specifics of the ordinance, but suggest that there is work to do before sending it to Town Council. Tonight, I hope to make 3 points clear. I speak as an advocate of minimizing our reliance on fossil fuels. Beauty must not be sacrificed for functionality when we have options. The Planning Board has both the authority and the obligation to protect our scenic vistas. So some of you sat on the Planning Board when I first joined the Energy Committee as a Town Council representative in 2009. For the next 6 years, I probably put in hundreds of hours to support energy initiatives for our community. I could go into all those details, and you can read them if you care. And I was just telling them because I wanted to establish my street cred as a dyed-in-the-wool active advocate of energy initiatives. As many of us have come to realize, writing zoning ordinances is hard. It's only when they're put to the test that one discovers gaps and unintended consequences, and that is the job before you on the Solar Energy System Zoning Ordinance. If nothing else, my time on the Town Council confirmed my belief that it is up to the Planning Board and the Town Council to seek input from all sources, including focused interest groups, but to then seek to integrate that input into the broader long-term benefit for the community. So here it comes. Some of you have heard me say this before, but I repeat it because it is important. I believe the original should be credited to a 13th century Persian poet, but today the version typically is, if you have two loaves of bread, sell one and buy a hyacinth. Durham must face practical realities, whether upcoming infrastructure expenditures or potential impacts of climate change. But we must recognize that just as we cannot develop our way out of a challenging state tax structure, we cannot save the world by allowing man-made mechanical structures to obliterate the features that make Durham an attractive place to live. I strongly disagree with those who think that we will come to view large freestanding solar energy systems as we do telephone poles today. These are not comparable. You will recall that the master plan over the decades have reflected the community's deep appreciation for our natural setting. Just recently, in the future land use chapter of the master plan, the section titled Quality of Place notes that scenic views of Little Bay, the Oyster and Lamprey Rivers, and numerous farms, forests, wetlands, and conserved properties contribute to Durham's special identity. The phrase special identity is an acknowledgement echoing decades of master plans that our history of valuing and protecting our rural setting is in part what sets us apart from neighboring towns. Also note the reference to scenic views. The 2000 Master Plan chapter on environmental and cultural resources dedicated a section to those scenic vistas, listing 34 specific locations in town where the view sheds offer something special. Those scenic views do not all sit on our gateways, but those that do tell me when returning from Portsmouth or Newmarket, or from Portland or Boston, or from longer trips, that I am coming home to, yes, a special place. I do not want to see those scenic vistas marred with large ground-mounted industrial solar panels. There is no reason why the Planning Board cannot build into its support for solar energy systems. The opportunity for community feedback when it is most needed by exercising tools specifically designed to do so, such as the special exception. This would not place an unreasonable burden on property owners. It simply reflects our social compact. Living in a community brings with it obligations to our neighbors. Some have claimed that the Planning Board either lacks the authority to, or simply should not, regulate on the basis of aesthetics. I want to address that point head on. First, the Planning Board already sets standards for aesthetics in its historic district zoning and in its site plan regulations. Second, no less an authority than New Hampshire's esteemed land use attorney, Peter Laughlin, has written explicitly about the authority of the Planning Board to zone for aesthetics. That authority is tied into the broad concept of the public welfare, one of the pillars on which a Planning Board's authority to regulate rests, as set forth in the town zoning ordinance, i.e., protecting the public health, safety, convenience, and general welfare of the residents of the town of Durham in accordance with RSA 674-17. I quote from Mr. Laughlin, "The New Hampshire Supreme Court eliminated any doubt about the ability of a municipality to use its zoning powers to promote aesthetics in Aslan v. Town of Conway, 298, where the court stated, we now conclude that municipalities may validly exercise zoning power solely to advance aesthetic values because the preservation or enhancement of the visualist environment may promote the general welfare. In addition, the New Hampshire Office of Strategic Initiatives website on planning resources includes a section on aesthetics, which I attached to my letter. The final citation is from a 2012 New Hampshire Municipal Association law lecture. Zoning for aesthetic reasons is generally permissible in New Hampshire. In Carlson's Chrysler v. City of Concord, 156 New Hampshire, 399, in 2007, the court upheld the city's sign ordinance, which prohibited moving signs against the plaintiff's First Amendment challenge, recognizing the valid municipal purpose of the ordinance to maintain public safety as well as maintain and enhance the appearance and aesthetic environment of the city. The court held that it was not necessary for the city to, quote, provide detailed proof that the regulation advances its purported interests or safety and aesthetics. The court concluded by unequivocally explaining that, quote, a municipality may exercise its zoning power solely to advance aesthetic values because the preservation or enhancement of the visual environment may promote the general welfare. And there's another court case as well that I mention here. And the quote from that is, the court disagreed with something, affirming as valid the purpose of the ordinance to promote aesthetic values, including preserving scenic vistas, discouraging development from competing with the natural environment, and promoting the character of a country community. So it seems very clear that it is within your purview to consider the protection of the fast-vanishing visual features appreciated by our community throughout our history, even as you work toward enabling important opportunities that look to our future. Thank you.
What song is this, Robin?
Pardon me?
What music is this?
They're definitely on everything.
I'm Phil Albright, 172 Packers Falls Road, and I'm here to talk about the impact, particularly of freestanding units for solar, whether it happens to be industrial, commercial, or residential, and that I am in the, just to let you know, I am in the landscape design and construction business. And so beauty is important to me. I'm not looking at the possibility of installing buffers, but I do request that all freestanding units, particularly if they're visible from the road, consider putting buffers in of some sort. As far as the solar tracker unit, number one, I don't feel like it's It's incongruent with the scenic vistas of our rural area, and if it's approved, that it be approved where you can put it behind a home or other buildings of a home, because I have not figured out a way to determine how do you screen a 25-foot array without destroying its ability to receive sun. So I'm also an energy consultant for Ambit Energy, and an affiliate of theirs is Sun Run, which installs solar, which just opened up New Hampshire on the, I think it was the 7th of April. And so I'm concerned that even though it might affect my business, that we take into consideration the abutters and the impact of solar freestanding units on the abutters, as well as the beauty of the area. Any questions, comments? Thank you very much for the opportunity.
Thank you.
Good evening. I'm Mary Downs. I'm on the Energy Committee, and I was here a couple of weeks ago talking about the ordinance. We had a very, very different kind of conversation about it. It's very interesting to listen to the comments tonight and to hear the genuinely heartfelt concerns of folks about aesthetics and about buffering and about the potential downside of solar in our community. I want to make a few points just to push back a little bit. I want to remind everybody that the master plan for Durham is very strong on the importance of renewable energy, both for the town as a property owner and as a converting its own energy use to renewable to the extent possible, and the strides that we've made towards that, and that the Energy Committee's goal in one of the goals in passing or in considering the ordinance before you was to promote the goals of the master plan. I want to also point out that it's going to be very difficult to attain self-reliance, or even, you know, we've been talking at the Energy Committee about moving towards 100% renewable energy in the town by some future date, 2040, 2050, somewhere in there. And I worry that with a restrictive ordinance that will not be, it simply will not be possible, that we can't just put solar on rooftops and get there. So that is a concern. I also want to point out that someone had mentioned Northern Pass, which is kind of ironic because the proposal for the Seacoast Reliability Project, I think it was called, that was proposed by Eversource to go through the town. These large-scale, and I'll point out, I work for Unitil. I do energy efficiency there. And so I can say with confidence that utility-scale transmission and distribution assets that we are generally, I think, in this community very dubious about and resistant to and find alternatives to in the means of energy efficiency or renewable energy, we will still have those and will need them in order to keep the lights on if we don't find alternatives like solar energy and other forms of renewable and homegrown energy, which also keeps the funds that would go towards those transmission and distribution projects and the generation assets, whether they're located in Durham or not, keeps that money from going towards those extremely expensive, centralized, capital-intensive projects that we pay 10% return on equity every single, you know, every year to the utilities, rather than when we build it ourselves, homeowner by homeowner, business by business, that money stays in our pockets and in our communities and is also a lot more efficient. There's a lot more of the energy that gets to the house than from the power plant. I also want to point out, very concerned about aesthetics. I love living in Durham. I live near the bay, and it is a beautiful place to live, and I also very much value that. But I think there's a little bit of an either-or dichotomy that's being set up here that is probably not appropriate. We can still have ground-mounted solar and preserve the aesthetics of the community, and I think that's maybe being lost a little bit tonight. I'd also like to point out that the aesthetics of climate change are not pretty. when you have rising waters, you've got floods, you've got storm surges, you've got trees coming down, you've got various insects and other pests that are killing our forests and our trees, our maple industry, the evergreens, which are I don't know all the names of all the terms, but the folks who are here and know about forests and about trees know that climate change is a serious threat to those. Durham isn't single-handedly going to keep climate change from happening, but if we don't recognize it, then our forests are going to be gone anyway, and the pests that are going to take advantage of that. And that is not something, the aesthetics of climate change is not something that the planning board or the town council or Durham voters can do anything about, other than to promote a more rapid transition to an alternative energy future. So that's basically all I want to say, and I look forward to hearing more comments both at this hearing and at other hearings. And I encourage people to find out more about the economics of solar and what it means to the town, and what the alternatives are to doing our own development of renewable energy here. Because the alternatives, I think, are more objectionable to most people in this room, I would pose. Thank you very much.
I'm Malcolm Sandberg, 15 Langley Road. Madam Chairman, members of the board, thank you for your endurance tonight. There's a lot of comments, and I'm delighted to hear that not yet have I heard anyone speak against solar power. I think, as far as I'm aware, everyone is in favor of it. And what we're here to discuss tonight is the language of the ordinance and how the ordinance can be most effective in accomplishing our goals. Some of my comments have already been mentioned, starting, so I won't belabor them, but my first point had to do with RSA 672.1, which is the RSA related to solar energy, where the language which Judith Spang specifically cited was that renewable energy shall not be unreasonably limited by use of municipal zoning powers or by the unreasonable interpretation of such powers, except where necessary to protect the public health, safety, and welfare. Pretty scary terms, and you might understand why people would say, wait a minute, we can't do anything. And I'd like to encourage the planning board, or if indeed, if the energy committee is still in existence, is that a fair assumption?
Yes.
And it was the energy committee that drafted this ordinance. Then, and so it may very well be that the comments that are being made tonight might be incorporated in a revisit. That is to say that if the planning board were to take all of these comments that we've heard tonight, give them back to the committee and let them work it through and maybe involve some of the members of the public that are speaking here tonight in their work. But anyway, the Durham ordinance at its outset should assert that its solar ordinance, our solar ordinance, is reasonable. Just come right out and say that it is reasonable and then say why it's reasonable. The term unreasonable, as used in the RSA, should not be interpreted to mean that all limits are unreasonable. We must be prepared to defend our interpretation of that vague term unreasonable, as used in the statute, to ensure the viability of our ordinance when it is finally adopted. So that's step one. Item two, solar energy is an evolving technology, and we shouldn't allow ourselves to be vulnerable to unintended consequences related to enterprise development. And enterprise development is specifically mentioned at some length in this draft ordinance. Enterprise development may be premature at this time in this rapidly evolving business of solar energy. And if it is to be allowed, if enterprise development were to be allowed on a commercial scale, it should certainly only be allowed by a special exception. And it it may also be wise for us to not have the enterprise development in our first involvement in this ordinance. It may be better for us to start in with allowances for solar development, but not going whole hog and saying enterprise projects are allowed anywhere in town by right. That's a little extreme, I would say. So, in addition, on paragraph, section 5, paragraph B, there is that section that says systems of any size are allowed. This is an unreasonable open door to potential opportunism. At this stage, the town should clearly hold on to its right to review applications rather than allow any size enterprise installation by right. That is an item that needs to be revisited in depth. Third, the town must clearly envision what a 500 kilowatt array would look like in terms of area and height. Most residential applications require roughly a 10 kilowatt array, 10 kilowatts. 500 kilowatts may be excessive. Space and setback restrictions for such an installation must be evaluated on a case-by-case basis and not allowed by right. The term special exception in our ordinance should be applied and used as intended in section 175.26. Fourth, the issue of taxability is not broached at all in this ordinance. And you may recall that at Article 172-7B, our ordinance states, a property owner of a building equipped with solar energy system, with a solar energy system, shall receive real property tax exemption equal to the cost of the solar energy system in that building. I think a non-taxable enterprise installation in the town of Durham would not be in the town's best interest if it's at the commercial level. That is an issue that must be addressed. Fifth, we might consider or ask the committee to look into the subject of carbon offsets in evaluating for an applicant to submit a carbon offset study. That is to say that by using solar power, we are theoretically reducing the amount of carbon dioxide emitted into the atmosphere. On the other side, if you were to pave areas or to obscure areas which are currently existing, have existing vegetation, that existing vegetation may not then consume carbon dioxide to produce oxygen as in the carbon cycle. So there may be some situations where there's a trade-off of losing the battle to some edge. I don't have any statistics on that, but it's just a concept that I think ought to be evaluated at some point. Finally, this was just recently mentioned, stationary arrays have a much lower profile than the trackers. The trackers are compact, they're much taller, they have a great deal of windage, but they have the ability to go onto a horizontal plane to basically luff the sail when the wind gets up. But they are a much greater visual impact in the area. And the ordinance should specifically address the distinction between low profile stationary arrays versus the mobile trackers and what the visual impact of that would be. So I offer these suggestions with the hope that the Planning Board will vote to return this ordinance to the Energy Committee with all of the comments that we've heard tonight so that they can rework this a little bit, come back again for a continued public hearing or for a new public hearing, and so that we can all work together to develop an ordinance which is clearly needed, but it needs to be done right carefully. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Madam Chairman. Thanks.
Good evening to the Planning Board. My name is David Williams. My wife and I live at 144 Packers Falls Road here in Durham. It was last August that a standing solar array was installed near adjacent to our home. And my take on it is that that event precipitated why all of us are here, frankly. I want to be really clear about, I support solar energy. I'm not fighting that. That's not the point. It deserves positive attention and careful attention. I want us to continue as a town to plan and build procedures that we can live with that are reasonable in the sense that it's been called into question, but nonetheless, and to do it in a way that can be specific, achievable, and measurable, and accountable. I think probably the single most important thing I want to share with you is the importance of making this a community project in terms of its our understanding. The technology is changing. In many ways, I think that we were, well, I feel like I was ambushed by this technology, but that's more of a subjective perception. But I wouldn't want the town to fall into unintended consequences, which could, in effect, serve as something like an ambush. I'm aware of a couple of pieces of correspondence that are available to us this evening that I think tend to erode the notion of a community conversation about this really important topic on solar energy. The first one is the sense of at least one voice that saw the differences between homeowners as trivial, that the major task was to reclaim the natural environment from its pollution, as though the people on the ground can be dismissed. At least that's the force of the comment. The second one was also the notion that somehow there was a dust-up among neighbors on Packers Falls Road. I think that too is dismissive. It doesn't take seriously the people who live on Packers Falls Road, or that both sides want good, clean energy. It's more, how do we get it? And how can we do it in a way that preserves the integrity of ourselves and our homes and our town? I have a deep commitment to the notion that communities count. There is certainly a place for individuality. All of you are individuals. I'm an individual. We want things for ourselves. But I can't have everything I want. I have to have some things I have to yield to the community. How about stop signs, for starters? I live on Packers Falls Road, and part of the reason I live there is because it's a scenic road. And it was designated by the town, as I understand, something like 1973 as a scenic road in our town. And to lose that insight, that town decision of some 45 years ago, it would be a terrible tragedy. The feelings that people have about what constitutes beauty, it's been alluded to on several occasions. It's not a veto, in my judgment, for technology, but it's a balancer for technology. I have to have some machines to do what we need to do in the 21st century, but we also need beauty, we need natural resources, we need the natural, the nature of our heritage, historic, agricultural, the trees and so forth, and the lands and the ponds that are near our homes. Those two are as valid a claim on the human spirit as is electricity. There's another word that gets tossed around a bit in some of the correspondence, and that's the word existential, as though that the problem of global warming is of such an existential concern that it erases all other concerns. At least that's an implication in some of the writings that are available to us in, at the planning board. I want to take exception to that and say that beauty is also an existential need. So is the life of the mind. And so is the sense of mutuality. And so such is a sense of history of who we are as a town. We've done many good things in this town, gracious Lord, since the 17th century. Doubtless we've made mistakes, and ones that we might wish to have done differently had we been there. Good community insight, inviting the public into this discourse. What I've heard really suggests a lot of complications, a lot of nuances that come from people who have historic perspectives, engineering perspectives, policy perspectives, legal perspectives. All of those deserve attention, and to make this fair and open, and not to allow our frustrations to drift into trivial, dust up, that's not okay. Be careful about that kind of language, try to be open and inviting to the complexities of this problem. There's a part of me, of course, that says, you bet, shove all that technology in the backyard, that's fine, put it in the front yard, get rid of it. There's a part of me that can readily adopt that position. I'm working on how to manage that position. What I'm really after is encouraging you to take a larger view of things. It's our town of our 8,000 people, something like that, and our 25 square miles, and the future that we've got, and this dynamic technology, and this dynamic demography that's facing us, the up-and-coming generations with their interests and concerns, which are a lot likely to be mine, although I should hope they might be. So, at any rate, I'm really pleased to take a moment to speak with you. My single biggest encouragement is not to allow your conversations and your procedures to slip into discounts, such as trivial or dust up. You'll find it in the correspondence. That's not going to be helpful. What will be helpful is to listen and see what we can do to work this out. If we can, well, those are my thoughts. So thank you for your time, and I'm glad to have been here this morning, this afternoon, and this evening. And I really appreciate all who have spoken on this matter. They have a lot of really good insights.
Hi, I'm Don Brodigam, 122 Packers Falls Road. I have a short letter to read that I composed. I also have one from Feroz that I wanted to read, so I'll kind of do both of those. So I'll start off, this letter that I wrote, it gets away from the struggle between balancing act between aesthetics and utility. And it just addresses somewhat of a nitpicky precision of the wording that I just wanted to bring up that I noticed. And that is, so I'm going to read this. The proposed changes in Article 2 definitions in the ordinance includes the definition for solar energy system as a structure and the related components used to transform solar energy into thermal, chemical, or electrical energy. This is a general term that refers to widely different solar energy conversion technologies, including that related to solar hot water systems, which converts solar to thermal energy, photoelectrochemical cells, which converts solar to chemical energy, and photovoltaic cells that converts the solar to electrical energy. So as it's defined there, that solar energy system, it really is talking about three different technologies with different aspects, characteristics to them, and so on. Yet that one word is used throughout the ordinance in specifying all the various limitations, constraints, and so on and so forth. It appears that the term solar energy system, as used throughout the proposed ordinance, is referring strictly to photovoltaic cell technology, as, for instance, in the proposed changes to Article 20, where the maximum allowed rated nameplate capacity is given as 30 kilowatts DC, or direct current. And more explicitly in the corresponding footnote number one, which refers to the size of the photovoltaic systems in kilowatts. That is, it does not address the permissible size of, for instance, a solar hot water system, which may also be roof-mounted or ground-mounted. To remedy the inconsistency, one needs either to replace the term solar energy system throughout the document with a technology-specific term, solar photovoltaic system, though this would eliminate any reference to the commonly used solar hot water systems. Or one needs to specify the size of the solar energy system in some more generic, perhaps geometric terms, to get away from the fact that it's specifically thermal conversion or electric conversion or whatever. So, lastly, it is my impression through a quick Google search that the inclusion of solar to chemical energy conversion technology, for instance, photoelectrochemical cells, within the generic term solar energy system may be premature in that it appears that the technology is still in its developmental stages, and it's not clear to me, at least me, what sort of system that would look like in terms of, you know. So it seems that most of the discussion that we've had so far tonight has been involving solar arrays, but solar arrays is just one of the three technologies that's listed within this general term, solar energy system. So something has to be reconciled for the inconsistency there, I think. Okay, so that's all I had. So I have this letter from Feroz Catrack. I'm not sure where he lives. He's Durham somewhere. Dear members of the Planning Board and Michael, a few suggestions for the proposed solar ordinance that you are currently reviewing. Delete, i.e. not allow, chemical energy from solar energy definition, from solar energy system definition. Keep only thermal and electrical. This is because most chemical energy systems are likely to have higher environmental risks from accidental leakage. Such systems may be water-based, but may also be based on the use of molten salts and benzene, and so on. Two, the words, a system mounted on top of a freestanding carport or over a parking lot, as used in the definition of freestanding system, are unclear. What does it mean, and are we sure we know what this will allow? Three, shared solar systems should not be permitted unless by special exception. Such systems are likely to have complex layouts that need to be reviewed and approved. Further, allowing 1 megawatt size as proposed seems excessive. The allowable size should be site specific, with some sites justifying only smaller sizes. Number four, enterprise solar systems should not be permitted anywhere in Durham. Such systems are likely to have complex layout and intensive use of land, such as clear cutting trees and so on. Further, allowing any sizes proposed is irrational. Huge size systems may be appropriate in desert-like settings like in Nevada, but clearly would be egregiously damaging to Durham's natural landscapes. Do we really want an Onassis refinery like solar monstrosity in Durham as allowed in current draft? I would suggest not. Number five, concentrating solar systems, which often use sunlight reflecting mirrors, should not be allowed in any kind of solar system in any setting in Durham. This issue is unaddressed in the draft. Number six, a positive aspect in this draft is that residential freestanding systems will not be allowed in the front yards. In addition to that, we should also require that any residential freestanding system shall be as unobtrusive for neighbors as passersby as possible. E.g., where possible, have the freestanding system backed up against trees. Number seven, lastly, the draft allows for residential freestanding systems to be placed in most of our zones with no or minimal reviews beyond building permit. This ignores and puts low priority on any impacts on our natural landscapes. While the draft ordinance has some cursory references to our need to balance need for solar versus preserving Durham's rural character, in effect, the proposal has no explicit practical way to limit impact on our rural settings. We should therefore either add requirements to meet some specific thoughtful standards to limit impacts of residential freestanding structures, or for the time being, we should limit residential freestanding structures to very few, maybe only one or two zones. Thank you. Regards, Faroz. So I'll note that, that's Faroz's letter. I mean, I don't necessarily agree with everything is written there, but that's, I'm reading it for his sake, and I'll leave these two with.
Thank you.
We have Faroz's letter.
Yeah.
Yeah. Good evening. Diana Carroll, Canny Road. I made some notes today, but I think I'd like to start kind of off notes and just say I really appreciated this evening hearing some of the very detailed comments that were made by people who read that ordinance very carefully, like Don Brottingham. And like Faroz Katrak and like Mel Sandberg, they read that carefully, and they have some really good things for us, I think, to look at. The other thing I wanted to say before I look at any of my notes is that I have the conclusion of what I wanted to say this evening after listening to other people. And that is what I kept hearing over and over again by the people who spoke this evening, is that what they're looking for is a win-win situation. People here are for solar energy. There's nobody who's talked against it. And people want to see more of it. I think if the planning boards would say, how many of you would like to see more solar energy? A lot, if not all hands would go up in this room. People want solar energy. People in the room, I think, also want our scenic Durham to stay scenic and naturally beautiful and unobstructed by things that would take away from that could be placed in a slightly different place and still be there. So I think that's what we're looking for. We're not looking for an either or, we're looking for a win-win. That's not necessarily easy to craft, and I know that's your job, and that's not an easy one to do. But between you and the Energy Committee and other people in town that are interested, I think it can be done. Definitely can be done. So that's my conclusion. I'll just make a few other comments. And that is, when I started thinking about this issue, I began thinking of our scenic roads, our four designated scenic roads. And I thought of what could be placed there that would jeopardize them. And of course, the large solar trackers is the first thing that comes to mind. But then I thought, well, what about our gateways? And what about the fact that so many roads in Durham are scenic and beautiful, and that's why it's great to drive down them day in and day out. And I also find that in the ordinance, if, for instance, a tracker cannot be placed next to a house, it can be set back 100 feet from the road in somebody's front yard or even closer to the road if it's a field. And I got the visual of traveling down one of our roads and seeing a couple of solar tractors there. And it would have a large impact because it means with this ordinance, they could be
more than one on a street, more than two, more than three. It could be up and down the street. It would change the way our roads look. And I immediately, as I said, scenic roads and our gateways came to mind. I think it's really important that any large installation, that there be complete transparency. And so we need public hearings for anything that's large. We need the community to be informed and to be able to follow this. It really is important. We have a legacy now of transparency in this town, in our town government. And I think that's very important to highlight and to say that we really need to keep that. I'd also like to underline the idea that one size does not fit all in this case. Just as I mentioned, setting back large solar trackers 100 feet from the road is not going to take care of preserving the scenic qualities in this town. So we can't have just, it's not a one size fits all, and that has to be looked at very carefully. Thank you very much. I would also like to suggest that we're on somewhat new territory. This isn't necessarily easy. It doesn't have to be done tomorrow or next week. It can take some time to make sure. The important thing is that it's done well and that we end up with good areas and a good ordinance for solar and also preserving our scenic visual area. Thank you.
Hi, my name is David Hills, and I live at 135 Piscataqua Road in Durham. And I wanted to start out by expressing appreciation to the board, also to the Durham Energy Subcommittee. And I wanted to also express my respect for other speakers tonight who I believe to be deeply concerned about the energy crisis that we all know is upon us. I also wanted to, I think it's very, at 63, I'm at a time in my life when I'm starting to recognize the difference between opinions and facts. And I think that most of us confuse the two and think that our opinions are facts. And our opinions are not facts. Our opinions are opinions. And I was a little troubled tonight by terms such as visual pollution, reasonableness, detrimental view. Those are all opinions, but I think people may be looking at them as facts. So my background, which brings me to talking on the subject, is that as many of my friends behind me know, that back in the time when I was supposed to be studying at UNH, I was really much more focused on trying to stop the Seabrook nuclear power plant and getting arrested some four or five times. I went down to the White House at one point and was arrested in front of the White House to object to the Dakota Pipeline. I'm a former energy auditor doing residential energy audits, and I spent 34 years focused on impact and sustainable investing. So how could money be used to create positive social impact in the world? So all of this has sort of built who I am, led to my opinions, not my facts. I happen to believe that solar installations are beautiful. Many of us have driven to Vermont, I'm sure, and I was very surprised a number of years ago when I saw the first solar installations in what were fields, tucked in the corners of fields, significant sized installations. And probably maybe different than others in the room, I felt hopeful when I saw those. I thought, wow, you know, we've been hearing about photovoltaics for many years and we're finally seeing them instead of just hearing about them. I think that my ability to put, in my case, photovoltaic panels mounted on the ground on my property at my financial expense is a right, and also for me, a joy for me to vote with my dollars for a future that is moving from carbon. And it's really important for me to be able to do that. And I'm afraid when I hear some of what I've heard and some of what I've read for the possibility that I may be told that I can't do this, where I may be told that I need to put up vegetative blinds or manufactured blinds, which make the economics of my passion less attractive. I think it's obvious to everybody in the room, we are really at a time of crisis. Five of the last 6 years, I believe, have been the hottest on record. Though our president doesn't know it, most of us in the room know that this is a really critical time. I would want to certainly focus on balance. I think a lot of great issues have been raised tonight, but I would like any regulation which discourages or unreasonably limits solar to be looked at with extreme care. I think this town should not send a message. Judith, I appreciate what, I think it was Judith, said about Hampton. if there's an example of what Durham does not want to be about, I would say we do not want to send out any kind of message like that. I'd really hope that we would send a very different message than the town of Hampton. So thanks very much. And questions, happily, but.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bob and Mauer, very quickly. I wanted to, I appreciate what David Hills just said, and I think it's making clear that we have, those of us who spoke before, were not strongly enough distinguishing between types of ground-mounted solar energy systems from a visual perspective. And I think that's something that perhaps should be clarified in the ordinance, because I would guess that there are many more people in this room and in town who would be aligned with the concept of wanting to promote the low profile systems for the very reasons that David Hill mentioned, and are much more concerned about the what one might think of as more visually intrusive, tall, freestanding systems. Thanks.
Beth Olshansky, Packers Falls Road. I do want to thank the subcommittee that worked hard to draft this ordinance and the Energy Committee for vetting it, and also now the Planning Board, who has to take on the task of integrating, I think, public interest into a broader perspective. I want to remind everybody that when we had the land use forum last spring, it was, and our hired consultant facilitator came to report on the findings of that effort. One of the things I recall distinctly was she said, one of the few things that Durham citizens really agreed about was protecting our rural character and scenic vistas. And she sort of laughed at that was, you know, while we have a broad range of views, that was one thing that almost everybody felt strongly about. So that's why I was very encouraged by the purpose statement of this proposed solar ordinance: to promote environmental sustainability while protecting the character of rural and scenic lands and the use of productive farmlands. I thought, great, okay. And as a visual person, I started driving around after I carefully read the ordinance to think about what it means, how this would be implemented. One of the things that was not provided in the, at least the packet that was online for the public, was a copy of the Table of Dimensional Standards. It's impossible to really visualize what's going on with the ordinance unless you understand the setbacks for each zone and also the height limits. So with this in mind, I have several points that I'd like to bring out. Front yard placement. I started thinking about, okay, is it ever appropriate to have freestanding solar systems in front yards? You know, my gut said I don't want to see them, but then I thought about my neighbors who live at the end of dirt roads that are private, or I think about my other neighbors who have a lot of vegetative buffers in front of them, or I think about other neighbors whose backyards are actually their front yards. So, you know, there's a lot of variety in Durham, and for that reason, I understand and support having special exception for solar trackers in the front yard. What I don't support is the caveat that if they're 100 feet back from the road, that's okay. A large solar tracker is no less visible 100 feet back from the road than 60 feet back from the road. These things are big. I think about my next door neighbor who has a 200 foot deep front yard. By this caveat, this would allow a large tracker plunk in the middle of a front yard. Additionally, when I look at the scale of what's allowed per single family home, the 30 kilowatts equals 5 to 6 solar trackers or 120 solar mounted systems, ground mounted systems. So with that 100 foot caveat in there, we're really opening ourselves up to perhaps more than we anticipated. I'd like to see that 100-foot caveat removed. I think the special exception opportunity allows for a case-by-case review of each situation, and that is appropriate and I think gives reasonable use of property. I'm also thinking about side yards, and I understand the thinking behind the regulation, the language that says ground freestanding systems can be placed in side yards aligned with the front of the, no further front than the front of the building or the house. But then I think about historic roads in Durham. So on Packers Falls Road, many of our houses are built very close from the close to the road. Some of them are even in the road right-of-way. Some of those houses have extensive side yards. I think about a former member of the planning board, Julian Smith, and I know many of you were invited to his house on occasion, and he has had a very long property, so scenic that he built a scenic outlook along the side of his road. His house, approximately 30 feet from the road, under this language, would allow for 5 or 6 solar trackers 30 feet from the road, blocking the scenic vista that extends behind it. In a 2-mile range from my house down to the end of Mill Road on our historic road, which is also a designated scenic road, I counted 12 properties that are fairly close to the road and that have extensive side yards. So either these ground freestanding systems could be placed even more forward than the road setback, or if even required to meet the setbacks in our collector road, which is 30 feet, we're still looking at having them very close to the road. And I'll also point out that the height regulations for residential uses is 35 feet, which is far higher than the than I think needs to be and than the typical even solar tracker is. So for the purposes of meeting the purpose statement of this ordinance, I think that all freestanding systems should be approved by special exception. And also, I think we need to look at beefing up our buffering language, and I'll get to that in a minute. There's also well, I'll talk about the buffering now. There is language about buffering, not specifically in the residential zones, but along some of the other zones. And there is no definition of buffer in this particular section, but I refer to the definitions in our zoning ordinance. Buffering, the use of landscaping other than grass on a flat terrain, or the use of landscaping along with berms, walls, decorative fences that at least partially and periodically obstruct the view. So that's our current definition of buffer. I find that troubling, or let's say inadequate, given that we're now talking about trying to buffer something that could be 35 feet high or higher, which I'll talk about when I get to looking at the commercial zones. So I think we need to beef up our buffer, And I know some other towns define buffering as fully screened, and that may be more adequate. I happen to live next door to an empty field along a scenic road. It's a separate lot of record, and I'm told by with a conversation from Michael that along our scenic road, that scenic meadow could hold and would be available for an enterprise system with no maximum anything. Setbacks from the road, 30 feet. Height limit, I guess, would be 35 feet, and any number of however many solar trackers or ground-mounted systems could fit. And again, with the language around buffering being somewhat weak. Looking at our gateways, it's kind of ironic that many of our commercial zones fall in our scenic gateways. So there's a little bit of a paradox there to wrestle with. Those gateways, because they are in commercial zones, allow for taller buildings. And at this point, this ordinance adopts the standard building heights for whatever is allowed. So in a favorite scenic road, Orly, Mast Road, Route 155, 40 to 50 feet high. These trackers would be allowed 40 to 50 feet high, only 50 feet from the road. So I think that we need to look at that. It's going to be hard to buffer. Interestingly, on OR 108, the height building heights allowed are 50 to 75 feet tall. Are we really saying that we're going to allow solar trackers 50 to 75 feet tall? Even if it was 50 feet tall, imagine that is the height of 911 Madbury Road. You know, is that something we really want? And as I think Councillor Welsh had wisely said last week, let's zone for what we want to see, not for what we might end up with if we don't think this through carefully. I'd like to see, well, and I'm noticing in the existing solar ordinance. There are several P's permitted by right for freestanding in the commercial zones. So in the, for an enterprise system with no maximum scale at all, permitted by right in several of our gateway commercial zones. The same with the multi-unit, non-industrial shared systems, also by right. And again, some of these have very large scale systems. I'll point out that for a single family house, which typically, I guess I read on the internet, uses 5 to 8 kilowatts, our ordinance allows 30. So that would be, if my calculations are correct, 5 to 6 trackers or 120 solar panels. That seems extensive for a single family use. The multi-unit residential category, those freestanding systems, the 500 kilowatts translates into 80 solar trackers or 2,000 ground-mounted panels. Food for thought. If we're going to do that, we better beef up our buffer language. I urge the planning board to really take to heart the purpose statement of this ordinance, which I think we all do believe in, and see if we can come up with what would I think would be a really ample use, encouraging solar, as we all want to see, and yet also being able to maintain what most Durham residents say is very important to them. And I do just a last point. I do think there's a big difference between in the freestanding, perhaps there should be a differentiation between ground-mounted, which could be lower, a lot lower, and the tall trackers. I did send Michael an email with this letter. It's good bedtime reading if you have insomnia, but I hope you'll look at it carefully someday when you're not about to fall asleep. Thank you.
Thank you.
Is there anyone else to speak?
Oh, Madam Chair, the Richard, the fellow who does the DCAT recording, gave a note to Bob with some comments. I assume he's a Durham resident. Anyway, it's a short comment, but I will email that to the board and we'll post it on the website.
What does it say, Michael?
Well, we usually do not. We usually do not have staff and planning board members read comments from those who cannot attend the public hearings.
Oh.
However, in this case, because it's so short and you asked, he said he questioned that a 10-foot height restriction on structure. I think was he saying
on his
on a
he
maximum.
He has such high trees in his around his house.
Having a 10-foot
would not allow him to
maximum
do
above the building would be too restricted because he has some very high trees around there. And so I guess wondering if it should be the height limit should be more than 10 feet. This is for building mounted systems other than panels that may be project above.
So. What do we want to do?
Close this public hearing or we discuss?
I think the first question is whether you want to close the public
hearing.
Well,
that's what I'm thinking about.
I mean, definitely, however you get to the next draft, there will be another public hearing.
Mm-hmm.
So, Michael, why don't we just close this one, come up with a new draft, and have a new one?
Sounds good.
Is that good?
Mm-hmm. Are you going to make a motion about that?
I will move that we close the public hearing.
I'll second it.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
So how do you want to develop the next draft and incorporate these comments and others?
You mean you want to talk about that, all of that now?
Well, or we could take that up at an upcoming meeting.
I mean, we have other...
Yeah.
I think the question I have is it something that we as a planning board are going to tackle, or are we going to, and I'm looking at Mary, who is on the Energy Committee, do we refer it back to them, as some people have suggested? So, or collectively, we all work on it.
I think we have to think about it, cogitate a little bit. I mean, I don't know how Mary feels about that, and you know, so.
Yeah, I mean, you have a few options. You could have me as the planner, you know, take another stab at it. Or I could give you another document that would just incorporate all of the comments that I've heard, the specific comments, into that document. So it's all, you can see everything there in place.
I think that would be useful.
That would be none of my own input, just incorporating specifics. So I could prepare that for you.
But some of the comments are in conflict with each other.
Yes.
Yeah. So
how do we incorporate that?
Well, I mean, I would, something I could do is just take all of these specific comments and just insert them into a document, so you could just see everything in one place, and then you can decide how to proceed.
Just a summary of what we heard would
answer your question. You would the ones that are conflict with each other, or perhaps in conflict with reality, or some other, you know, all of that would be revealed. I think that's very.
Yeah, I mean, I could either take all of the, again, general comments like, you know, we all support solar, or, you know, I don't think you need for me to write that down into any kind of document. You know that. But any comments that we've received that are specific, height limits should be decreased, buffers should be increased, separate trackers from other systems, make special exceptions. Those are specific comments. I could either just simply compile all those, or I could compile those and insert them into the current draft, so at least you can see all, these are all the comments about section 4G.
Mm.
What do you want to do with it?
Yeah.
So, I mean, that might be a good next step.
That is, I think it's great. I also think that, I am no physicist, but I have a feeling that there would have to be a limit in terms of physics on how high a solar tracker could get before it would blow over, and I don't know, Mary, do we have that kind of expertise?
Yes.
Aha. That answers that.
And we want to make sure we take the time to get it right.
Yeah, absolutely.
So, we don't need to resolve this next week. Certainly, I think we've got a lot of work to do.
And we also have a workshop coming up in a month, which is limited to planning type items. I don't know if you want to put this on the agenda for that evening or not.
I think we can think about that.
Yeah. I mean, the further we get from tonight, the more you forget stuff. So I would be more in favor of doing something quicker as opposed to later.
Another thing that just occurred to me, you made me think of it, because I think you're the one that first brought up the Hampton ordinance, which is like this long. As I recall, the Hampton ordinance was developed in 2009, and I'm wondering if there even were solar trackers in 2009. No. So that would, I mean, I'm not sure. I mean, I would be all in favor of talking with other planners or other towns with the ordinances that have been in place for a while, to see how they're working and whether they've been challenged or et cetera. So that's sort of another thing that I think we owe it to.
Mary might want to have a comment.
Just really briefly, and as a point of
information. Durham is on, like so many things, on the cutting edge of developing an ordinance for renewable energy. I'm not saying we're the only ones in the state, but people are actually literally looking to us to see how they should proceed. So I'm not sure we're going to find a whole lot yet.
Mary, did you talk with other towns when you did put this together?
I was not on the subcommittee, believe it or not.
Did the subcommittee?
I believe so, Barbara and Michael, you would know better.
We didn't actually speak with other towns. I think we talked about doing it, but I know.
We looked at some other ordinances.
We did look at many other ordinances.
There's also a model ordinance that it's not OEP anymore, the Office of Strategic Initiatives developed, and I believe that, you know, Clay Mitchell, who lives next door in Newmarket, is a kind of an expert on this,
Clay Mitchell evaluated our ordinance and made a few suggestions, and
so there was consultation, and obviously more can be done. Thank you.
So what do we decide?
Michael is going to compile the comments.
I can do that for the May 9th meeting. That's what you'd like.
Are we going to do something with them at the May 9th meeting?
I'm sorry?
Are we going to do something with them at the May 9th meeting?
Yeah.
Okay, so it'll be an item on the agenda and we'll talk
Absolutely,
about it.
Yeah.
Okay. Can you try and get them to us? Reasonably before the meeting.
Well, it'll be in the packet. I don't think I'll be able to get it.
I got my packet on Monday, and the meeting's Wednesday. Doesn't give me much time.
They're mailed Friday, so they
I used to have that problem
Saturday.
Because they go from here to Manchester and then here.
And back.
Even though
pick mine up, typically, for that, just to avoid that.
On Friday, here.
Yeah.
Mine came Saturday.
Friday afternoon.
Yeah. No, Saturday's fine.
Does anyone get them on Saturday?
I get mine on Saturday.
I occasionally get them on Saturday.
I used to. I had problems, as you know.
Yeah. So, but we'll have it in the regular packet.
Okay.
Earlier if possible, but.
Okay. Thanks.
So,
All righty then. Next.
So the public hearing's closed.
So can we go on to the next one?
Yeah. So people understand that the planning board is going to continue to work on this. At some point we'll, I'm sure, have a revised draft, and then there will be a new public hearing for that.
Getting them on fries on Saturday.
What?
If he does sauce.
Yeah.
Really no, puts a crimp.
That was hard. Yeah, you try and prepare.
I spent all day yesterday putting this on this packet. It was a big packet.
Yeah. Yeah. So unusual.
Do we? No.
Okay. I mean, I don't think so.
All right. Let's see. Next, we have. Lot line adjustment and lot combinations on Colony Cove Road. This is a lot line adjustment on map 12 between lot 25 and lot 26. That's 22 and 18 Colony Cove Road, respectively, for the purpose of providing frontage for lot 26 on Little Bay. Also combining map 12. Lots 16 to 24 and 26, and map 12, lot 25, and I'm sorry, Michael, what is this? Lot 25 and?
Oh, where?
0.25 acre outparcel.
Oh, 0.25 acre parcel.
I mean, I see what it says, but I don't understand it.
Yeah, so it involves three things, a lot line adjustment and two different lot combinations. Lots 24 and 26, and lot 25, and a quarter acre out parcel.
Oh, okay. Well, maybe if it said A in front of 0.25, it would make more sense.
That.
All lots are owned by Mary Ann Loans, Aaron Worth, and Richard Hallett, Adam Fogg, Atlantic Survey, Surveyor, RC District. Hello.
Hi, thank you for your time tonight.
You've waited a long time.
Thanks
thank
for
you
your
for
patience.
Your patience.
It was my first town meeting. It was inspiring, actually. So I'm Mary Aaron Worth, and this is Rich Hallett, and we live out on Colony Cove Road, which is a a really lovely part of Durham out in Little Bay. And so what's the best way for us to proceed? Should we tell you a little bit about it, or do you want to just ask us questions, or?
Is your surveyor here?
No, we have all his paperwork.
I have to say that I looked at this survey plan you have here, and I cannot figure out what you're trying to do.
Okay.
And I don't know whether it just me or other people had difficulties, but I don't know whether it needs colors or something, but
I
read what you said you're going to do, and I looked at this, and there's so many different lines, and it's very difficult to follow.
So
I wrote the word complex right here as I was reading it, which it is, trying to get through it. And
I think I'm not saying it's not something that should be done or should not be done, but it's very difficult to see from the information we have here just what it is on the ground you're trying to do.
Yeah.
I'm not sure what we can do about that.
Yeah, I can color it myself and mark it up, and I'll have it for
that
next.
Would be very useful.
Yeah, I think if
we're going to have a site visit, mm-hmm. certainly I'd want to see something like that before we get there.
Yeah, I'll color that up and send that to the next meeting. Yeah. I don't think they need to have their surveyor do that. I'm just gonna use my crayons.
Maybe we could do it before that, because we might want to schedule a site visit before that.
Yeah, I'll make sure, if you do have a site visit, I'll make sure to do it well in advance.
But they could color it now.
Okay, anyway. So I don't have any questions, but because I'm not sure exactly what's happening.
Maybe just to talk about it in principle. I think I understand it in principle. I agree that it's difficult.
You know, if you don't mind, why don't I just come around each person and just show you some, if that's all right.
You don't have something you can put on the board.
I can
project. Are we allowed to project?
No, I don't mean it.
The key thing is really just
1624.
Yeah, I think I got it.
Oh, so you think you know. Okay, Bob, should I show you?
Yeah, they're
here?
Trying to get more frontage from 26, they're just
swinging this over to there so they'll get frontage on
on the water.
Yeah. Should I show this to anyone else? The main
show
thing
to me.
Doing is they've got it's two lots, 26 and 25. And this is 25. They live here. They want to get frontage on the bay, so they're swinging this lot line up to here, which will then give them like a flagpole and frontage on the bay for a dock. It's hard to see.
It is.
I know.
I mean, you look at the legend, and the legend is about four lines that look identical.
We had large-scale plans delivered.
We
had large-scale plans delivered. Did they get? Did you bring them in?
I don't think that would make it any. Oh.
Yeah, that's all right. I'll just color it up and mail it out.
Okay. Thank you.
Oh. Yeah. So, I mean, Madam Chair, maybe just there's the key thing is just a lot line adjustment between lots 26 and 25, which is just really swinging a section of the lot line up so that the interior lot will have 75, will connect to Little Bay, and they'll have frontage there so they could have a dock. That's the main thing. But then they're also combining an existing lot above 26, 24, and 26 together. And then they're also, this is confusing on the maps, but there's a sort of an out parcel up above where the road comes in that's we have wrong on our tax maps, and they're just combining that with lot 25. But the main thing is the lot line adjustment. The two lot combinations are generally handled administratively. It's regulation the board adopted many years ago that the staff approves lot combinations. But on this plat, they're showing the lot line adjustment, which is your purview, and two lot combinations, which is generally staff, but the planning board could approve those as well. So since it's all on one plat, we thought it might just be simpler for the board to look at everything.
And your home is on 26, right, where you live right now?
Our home is on 26, right.
So the lot line is going to provide the frontage to lot 26?
Right.
Mm-hmm.
So would provide a little frontage on Little Bay, right, to lot 26.
Okay, so in your planner's review, in paragraph one, that second sentence is incorrect then. The purpose is to provide some frontage for
right,
lot 25.
That should say frontage for lot 26. Yeah. Good catch. So the I think the planning board's work, a lot line adjustment usually doesn't involve very much, and I don't think there's too many issues. The issue is more for the zoning board because they need a couple of variances, and they'll be on the zoning board's agenda May 8th. So they have the bigger question before you, and then if this is approved, then they will likely apply to DES for a doc. So you certainly have judgment.
But that has nothing to do with this, right?
It does not, yeah.
So our mission is to...
Is the lot line adjustment and the lot combination. I mean, you could defer the lot combination to staff, but it's pretty perfunctory. It could all be done together. But as I sent a note to the applicant today, if it's on the plat and approved, then the lot combination would be required.
Mike Malone, what do we look for on the lot line adjustment? When you say it's our purview, what are the considerations that might lead us to say, no, this is a bad idea?
Yeah, I've never seen one be denied, but I'm sure they have been. If somebody was changing a lot line in a way that ended up with a very highly gerrymandered lot that was highly irregular, the purpose seemed, inappropriate. If it created any encroachments, they have to move structures. If it created any kinds of problems with odd lots or lots that will no longer be able to have an area for leach field, access problems.
Okay, but the only thing that I can see that might be an issue is sort of environmentally. Right now, is there a house? There's your house on 26.
Yeah.
And having 75 feet isn't going to allow you to move a house closer.
Oh, no. There's a 200-foot setback from the bay. You can't build anything.
And then is there a house on 25?
Yeah, so that was my mom's house, and that's how we ended up in this position. Is originally my mom lived in Durham forever and was really dear to us, and we built our house so that we could be right next to her as she was getting elderly. And she carefully, because the lot that we're asking for waterfront had waterfront,
yeah,
and she redid the lots thinking when she dies many years later that we would move into her house. Mm-hmm. Only the minute we finished our new house, she died. And we just can't afford to redo her house and move out of our, we just
so
can't do it.
Are you thinking
it.
Of selling her house?
Yeah.
And this area up above will make it a bigger lot.
Slightly bigger.
We'll end up,
yes, exactly. Yeah. We thought if we take this little piece game from hers, which was originally attached to our property, mm-hmm, we would give back part of the field so that lot just didn't lose any size. Plus then we'd be putting a dock in, but that meadow,
is 24.
Lot 24. Yeah. If we can get that little piece of waterfront, then we don't have to sell the meadow. The meadow is really good for all our neighbors. We did a prairie restoration. It's really beautiful. Kids play in it. People walk their dogs in it. And so it wouldn't be a house lot anymore, which it was in use under my mother's, and we lost the use for it when she died. But this way, that would also not be a building lot anymore.
Why not?
Because we'd combine it with lot 26.
It would be combined. Yeah,
yeah, exactly. And we already have we built a small house that looks like a barn. We really tried to be good to our neighbors.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Yeah.
You've spoken with all your neighbors and...
We're in good terms with everybody on the Cove, yeah. And my mother was, you know, dear to everybody. She was dear friends with a lot of people who are here tonight.
So, Michael, I'm not really sure what we have to do here.
Yeah, it's actually pretty straightforward.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't even think you need a sidewalk. I don't know that there's much to see unless...
Doesn't sound like there is.
Yeah.
Well, it'd be fun to see the bay, but...
Well, that would be fun.
You could come out anyway, anytime.
That would be fun.
I like that.
Can I just say that having watched the town planning tonight, I feel like you could come out anytime and just have a glass of wine. Because, yeah, but whatever.
As long as it's not raining.
Yes.
It is muddy right now.
Yeah, I don't really think there's anything to see.
So I'm fine. I mean, it seems like the ZBA has, you know, a lot to work through, but right. I'm not sure we need anything else.
But we need to schedule a public hearing.
Yeah, yeah, for May 9th.
Okay, so we make a motion.
Oh, I move that we still need
public hearings for lot line adjustments?
Yeah.
I know, it's so excessive.
I'm pretty sure that we... yeah, we usually actually do the lot line adjustments in one meeting. Yeah.
With
and
the
I schedule a public hearing.
Yeah.
Right, we usually do them in one meeting, but because they needed a variance, it made sense just to present and do it as two.
So I move that we set a public hearing for May 9th.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
What happens at that?
And no sidewalk.
No sidewalk. Say, they want to drive down ourselves and just take a look.
Anytime. Absolutely.
Yeah. Oh, actually, that's right. If people would be encouraged, if you
of course
want to see it,
anytime.
To it's private there, but I'm there's a driveway, but yeah, people anytime would be welcome to go look at it, right?
Yeah, no.
What about the promised glass of wine?
Exactly. The door is open.
Exactly. I was hoping for cookies.
Well, both. No,
it is really lovely. I mean, that part of Little Bay is really pretty. So what happens at the public hearing? Do we need to prepare anything more?
Public hearing, coloring most likely the board would take final action that night and
okay
see if there's any issues, unless there's any issues that arise.
And then we go to the ZBA the next night?
Yeah.
Okay.
So you'll be at the ZBA the night before?
Yeah.
Okay, oh, right.
Should the surveyor be with them here at the public hearing?
You know, I don't, I mean, that's, it would be helpful if you'd let them know, but I don't see any need.
We don't require it.
Okay.
And it gives the public an opportunity to comment,
of
if
course
anybody.
Okay, thank you. So that's it for tonight.
Yeah.
That's it.
Okay,
thank you. And thank you for your service.
Go have a glass of wine. Think of us.
Okay.
So now.
Next victim.
Why, it's Mike Siebert. So what is next?
No, he's not up yet. Next.
Cedar Point.
Siebert Point?
What? Cedar Point, yeah.
Oh, I was going to say, we name it.
Not yet.
Point after Mike.
Okay, 32 Cedar Point Road, conditional use. Conditional use for accessory structures to accommodate new house, replacing existing house, including driveway, patio, retaining walls, steps, and well. Heiderscheid? Revocable Trust, property owner, Steve Riker, Ambit Engineering Designer, Map 12, Lot 1 to 8, RC District.
Thank you.
Oh, great colors.
All right, thank you, Steve Riker from Ambit Engineering. Here tonight representing Ben and Manisha Heiderscheid, property owned at 32 Cedar Point Road in Durham. Ben and his wife recently purchased this property, and what they would like to do is tear down the existing home that's there and rebuild a new home. The colored exhibit that I just handed out is just a visual aid, because the plan is very busy. It's essentially the same plan that I have here on the easel, and I just want to point out some things quickly in regards to this colored exhibit. that will make things much easier to understand. First of all, the property is bounded to the south by Little Bay. It's bounded to the north by Cedar Point Road. The reference line is the highest observable tide line, which is located at the bottom of the plan. And you'll see it's a line that's labeled HOTL. And then from that line, the 125-foot Durham Conservation Overlay District is drawn from that. So I provided Michael yesterday via email with a revised plan that shows that 125-foot line. The plan that you have only has the 100 on it. So what I can tell you is that the 125 moves through the property at about this location. So I would say that roughly 85% of the parcel is located within the Conservation Overlay District. So the plan that you have, the colored exhibit that I handed out, the area that you see in green, the outlined area in green, is the existing house that's there now. And that house is located 46 feet from the highest observable tide line. The area that I've colored in pink is the proposed house. And that proposed house is located 59.6 feet from the highest observable tide line. So we're moving the structure 13 feet further away from the water than it currently exists now. The area outlined in the orange is the existing gravel driveway that's on the property now. We're going to replace that existing gravel driveway with a pervious paver driveway, and that area is colored in blue on that plan. And then lastly, and the reason I outline this is because the driveway and the patio are sort of one structure on one elevation, so to speak, and that pervious paver patio is colored in yellow on the plan. The lot slopes from north to south, so that would be from Cedar Point Road to the water, obviously, at a pretty decent slope. The house that's there now is built into the slope. The house that we're proposing is also built into the slope. The rear of the house, that would be the portion of the house that's located closest to the water, would have essentially a walkout type basement. So we were able to fit this new house into the lot nicely, just like the existing house. We tried to design this proposed house to occupy a very similar footprint as the existing house that's there now. There is some retaining walls alongside the driveway and the proposed paver patio. The walls serve a couple purposes. One, it maintains that elevation off Cedar Point Road for a car to make a turn and enter into the proposed garage, and also maintain the elevation so that you could walk into the front door of the house via the pervious paver patio. The walls that will support the pervious paver patio and the driveway serve that purpose of keeping that elevation, but also reduce any grading outside of those walls. If you were to try to elevate that land to make that work with grading, you would have to grade so far, we'd be onto the neighbor's property, and it wouldn't be a feasible project component. Some other things I want to mention. The current well, it's believed it's in the basement of the home. So there will be a proposed well located approximately right in the middle of the proposed driveway in the blue area that you see there. There's a W with a circle around it. That's the proposed well.
Know where the current well is?
In the basement of the house.
Oh. You said
the word. Sorry, did I misspeak?
Yeah, the word you used made me think you didn't know where it was.
Oh.
You said is presumably.
The owner seems to think it's in the basement of the home.
Oh, okay.
We didn't, as part of our survey and engineering, we knew we would be proposing a new well somewhere on the lot. That's the information that we received from the property owner.
And how high is the base of the house above sea level?
base of
the
house.
Is that 18 feet? It looks like there's a...
So the basement elevation is 19.5.
Okay. So no impact, Michael, from our new regulations?
Oh, well, they would have to comply with the 2 feet of... They'd have to go through that with Audrey and meet the 2 feet of freeboard, if they haven't already.
But it seems like they have it, right?
Pardon?
It seems like they would have the 2 feet of freeboard, right?
Well, she'll check to make sure they do.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'm assuming you're referring to...
In our flood zone?
Flood
regulations?
Yeah. I can get better details of where the flood hazard line is, what elevation that is at, but I can tell you that in this area along the bay, it's usually somewhere between 6 and 8.
Okay.
And we're at...
And you're at 18.
We're at 19 point...
Yeah, okay.
19.5, so I don't see it being an issue, but I will clarify that for the next meeting. Existing septic is rather unknown. There's a pipe leaving the house. We didn't do a whole lot of investigation into that because we knew we would be replacing that as well. So we're proposing what's called a advanced on-site septic. It's the best septic technology available these days. It consists of a tank with an aerator in it and some media in it as well. So your treatment occurs in the tank, not in the leach field. It's essentially a mini sewage treatment plant. Effluent enters the tank where it's treated anaerobically with the aerator, and it exits the tank and goes to the field. What it does allow for is it allows for a much smaller field, and it allows for a smaller separation between the bottom of the field bed and the seasonal high water table. They work extremely well, certainly on small lots such as this where you need to fit a field somewhere, and also with the concerns of nitrogen in and around the bay with old septic systems. This is the best septic system available. The owners will be required to sign a contract with Advanced On-Site Septic, which includes yearly maintenance and inspections as part of their contract. So that's nice as well, because now you know you have a field and a tank that need to be functioning.
Do they need DES approval?
Yes.
System? Yes.
Yep, and it's been submitted.
I think I might have just had an epiphany. Is there an air compressor involved somewhere?
There is.
And is that what does the anaerobic?
Correct.
Aha.
Correct, yeah. Yes.
I'm so happy to learn this.
Yeah, yeah. And so okay. The tank is actually, there's electricity run to the tank as well. And there's an alarm that if power goes off, the alarm will sound to notify the homeowner that it's no longer operating in the tank, to let them know that they have an issue and they need to fix it. So there is a system of checks and balances there to make sure it works. I'm sorry?
Well, what is the homeowner to do if the power's out?
Get it fixed.
Yes, it would just alert them, you know, maybe their power's out for, you know, a telephone pole down the street. Also, the power could be out for another reason.
Yeah, okay.
And this would alert them to that fact. The line gets severed between the house and the tank. Now they would know. As you can see, there's an impervious surface table on the plan as well. You can see we have a reduction in impervious surface on the lot, and you can see the line items in the chart that show where our gains and our losses are. We think this is probably the largest selling feature of this project, is that we're reducing some impervious surface. Stormwater will be improved entering Little Bay due to the reduction in impervious surfaces. You combine that with state-of-the-art septic. We think this project is certainly an improvement from what is there now, and certainly fits within the spirit and intent of your ordinance, as well as the DES, which with this project will require a shoreline permit and a DES wetland permit. The shoreline permit's already been approved, and the wetland permit is under review. And also the septic system has been submitted, septic design has been submitted to DES as well, and that's also under review. So
why is gravel considered impervious?
Gravel is considered impervious because if it's driven on or parked on, you have soil compaction, and essentially it can act.
So this is all driven on and...
It is, yeah. It's sort of a sprawling sort of parking area in front of the house. I believe I submitted a DS app with some photos. You can see there's sort of a, you know, Cedar Point Road along this stretch is gravel, and then they have this just gravel sprawling, I don't know how to even describe it, but an area of parking between the house and Cedar Point Road that they utilize for parking vehicles.
Could you just give us a brief description of these pervious pavers?
Sure. So the pervious paver could be, it's a manufactured product. It could be any shape, size, color.
Is the paver itself impervious or the way it's put together?
It's the way it's put together. So the paver could be made out of a variety of different materials, but it's the construction methodology is what makes it pervious. So we start with the base. Essentially, you need to provide some space, some pore space underneath the paver material to provide for the infiltration and storage. So there's some excavation involved. We're looking at 24 to 36 inches. We fill that with crushed stone. That creates the pore space. The paver itself is then placed on top of that. And obviously, between the pavers, you need to have a joint space to allow the water to move between the pavers. And in that joint space, you fill that with a finer aggregate that allows water to percolate through it, but maintain the integrity of the surface to be able to walk on and drive on and whatnot. So it does need to be constructed properly. That's why we do have a detail on the D1 plan that you have. There is a detail there. So,
but the paver keeps the aggregate from being crushed down like the gravel?
Yeah, exactly, yeah. So it's like a tile in your... You know, in your house, you've got grout, and in this case, it's a finer aggregate. It stays in the cracks.
And it's below the level of the paver.
Yep, okay. Yep. We've actually provided, my coloring is a little, I don't want to say misleading, but we have a cobblestone apron, and the reason for that cobblestone apron is any vehicle coming off Cedar Point Road, which is gravel, would have fine materials on the tires. The cobble is there to knock off that material on the tires and leave it on the gravel on the cobble before it enters onto the paver. Over time, fine materials on pervious pavers would clog those pore spaces, and it just wouldn't function as well over time. So that's a maintenance thing.
Are the cobblestones considered pervious as well?
You could construct them that way, yes. I mean, you could...
That's not what's... I mean, you have a different...
We don't have a detail for that. We certainly could provide a detail for that. You could construct them that way. I think over time they would end up acting a little more impervious because, again, the purpose of that cobble is to knock some of that material off. It would be a serious maintenance project if you wanted to maintain that as a pervious surface. In terms of construction, I think you would treat that entire area all the same when you go to build it. You would lay the same base underneath the cobbles that you would with the pervious pavers. And lastly, I wanted to mention that that Ben has spoken with both neighbors. Both neighbors have provided concurrence as part of the DES requirements for the wetland permits. Just wanted to add that both neighbors have seen the plans and they've provided written concurrence. That should be actually in the application that you have.
Is everybody finished asking questions? Mm-hmm. So do we want to set a public hearing?
I'll make a motion that we set a public hearing for this project for May 9th.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
I wouldn't mind a site visit.
Yeah, I could find it interesting.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, well, let's try, if we're going to do that, let's try not to set it for May 9th. So that Bob will have time to write up his minutes and turn them in. Is that okay with everybody or not?
I prefer it May the 9th, but I'll go to whatever we want.
I mean, I'm fine with the 9th. I mean, the fact that we don't have the minutes, I don't think it's stopped us in the past.
Okay, well then.
I mean, we make them, you know, I'll get them as soon as a day or two after.
It's a discipline for Bob.
Okay, then.
It gives you a rush.
Yeah, well, that's good. Okay, as long as you don't feel like it's a waste of your time.
No, I don't think I've ever been able to have the minutes prepared before we have a public hearing.
I think maybe once or at the very most. Okay, Lauren, have it your way.
Thank you.
So what time?
4 o'clock.
4 o'clock.
May the 9th. Does that work?
4 o'clock?
Good.
Does.
Okay. See you then.
Thank you.
Okay.
Okay.
Are we done yet? Oh, no.
You want to take a long break now?
Till 10. 10 or 1.
Can you do it in 6 minutes?
Yes. You saved the best for last, I see. I knew Michael was my buddy.
Well, everyone hates me, whoever I put last, but this was actually the most complicated of the three, so I had to go last.
Make it simple.
Yeah, I know.
Have I read this? I don't think I have.
It was in the packet.
This is a lot line adjustment on map. I hadn't read this.
Packers Falls.
Packers Falls.
Yeah.
I wouldn't admit that.
It's got the road from you.
207. It's around the curb.
Yeah, up the curb. Yeah.
195 and 207 Packers Falls Road, lot line adjustment and conditional use. Lot line adjustment on map 17 between lot 14 and lot 15. Conditional use for proposed driveway and utilities for a new house to be located within 100 feet of a wetland buffer. Both lots are owned by Daniel Huntoon. Mike Sievert, engineer, rural district. Period.
There you go.
Why are we talking 100 feet wetland buffer? Wasn't it 75 this afternoon?
Oh, this is zone rural, so it's 100.
Different. Okay. Thank you. Wow.
All right, good evening. I'm Mike Sievert with MJS Engineering, and this is Daniel Huntoon's property. It is at 207 and or 195 and 207 Packer Falls Road, and it's a lot line adjustment and a conditional use. And so I colored it up, and so the simplest thing is to look at these two plans up here in the corner. This is what it looks like today. There's a small 2-acre lot here, existing now.
Oh, can you speak into the mic?
Oh, yeah. There's a small 2-acre lot right there, shown in green, and then the orange is the remaining property. And that is, for tax map reference, that's lot 15 and lot 14. And then what we're proposing is the lot line adjustment to look like that small corner or this right here. So transferring this over to there and just reconfiguring the lots. So we end up with a 4.5-acre lot and I think about a 12-acre lot, if I'm not mistaken. Yeah, 12, a little over 12 acres. So there's an existing house on this one now, and this one is vacant, and obviously the new one is vacant there too. So that's the lot line adjustment piece of it. And then the conditional use piece is we are going to use the existing, there's an existing driveway. It comes right off of Packers Falls Road here, comes down in and accesses the existing house. And
we'll just use that same driveway because there's a wetland across this whole front right here that you can see that's delineated on the parcel and actually comes down to the river. Here's a the Lamprey River right here, and so this the larger lot has frontage and on the river, and then the new or the reconfigured lot does not. So that conditional use is because of the tie-in from the existing driveway to the new lot right there. Also, there was discussion about the conditional use for utilities. The regulations talk about subdivisions having to have utilities underground. Currently, the utilities are overhead, and they come right down the driveway and come right to this house right now. I believe I've asked for a waiver to keep the utilities overhead. I don't really want to take the all the poles down and dig and put them underground where it's already overhead in here. There's a pole right here just outside of the buffer, and I can go underground from that existing pole that's on the driveway in the property already across to the new house. So the access or the utilities for the new structure can be underground on its own property from that. So I think I'll just need the conditional use for the driveway connection in the end. So that's it.
Yeah. Mike, can you explain why this that larger lower property has that funny looking dog leg thing with a lot inside it? Why is that like that? Do you know?
Well, I don't know exactly, but there must have been a lot cut out of that some time ago that isn't owned by the Huntoons. So that being a separate parcel that's outside of that right there. And I don't know why that little piece was left there.
And there's no house on it or building or anything, I don't think.
On this lot here?
Yeah. Oh, there is?
Yeah, I guess. Yeah, I didn't know that either. There is a house that sits up close to the road right there.
Oh, okay.
It has a septic system, I think, right out front, right on that corner there. That might be the one.
Michael, is the whole purpose of this to make two building lots?
To make this lot much more buildable than this existing lot right here. This lot, or that larger orange lot right now, there's an existing house on it, so.
No, but that's what I mean. So right. Basically, you're making two lots out of one. You're making two buildable lots instead of having one buildable lot. Yes?
Yes, kind of, but existing.
There's two lots now. And
there's two lots now, though. This is an existing lot of record.
Is the green one buildable?
With variances or special exceptions, it could be, yes.
Okay, so basically I have one buildable lot, now you have two. It's kind of what you're doing.
Yeah.
It's just asking.
Yeah, I mean, this would be tough to build on. Yeah. That's why we're doing it. But I suppose it's been done.
You'd have to jump through hoops to get that.
Yes.
So when you say here, you're doing this to create a more usable lot with less environmental restrictions for development.
You're basically
saying you have this kind of weird, unusual two lots, and you're going to make them so you can build on both. And one already is built on, but the plan is to build a new one.
Yeah, that's right.
And the new one doesn't have river access.
No. So really, one lot has only river access. Yeah.
Whereas, so this is. How far back is the new lot from the river?
Let's see.
You can just roughly.
About 700 feet.
So it's way corner.
And that little jog right there is about 600 feet, probably. Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
having another septic system or something isn't going to have an impact on the river.
No, not on the river, no. No. Whereas it potentially could down there. You know, it'd be a lot closer down there and a lot closer to the wetlands and so forth. The other thing, I did say, in much more environmentally friendly up here, also the access would be pretty tough right on that corner right there on that. So this one puts, again, no additional access. So that's,
right.
I guess I didn't even say that as a benefit, but that is kind of another benefit.
It's kind of a benefit.
So, yeah.
Mike, you've had approvals from New Hampshire DES on subsurface and subdivision.
I just have the subdivision. I just went and got a subdivision approval because this is it's less than 5 acres, so we had to get subdivision approval. So we did do test pits.
You don't need the other one?
We do need a septic system approval, but I don't have it yet. We'll wait till the house, you know, till they build a house.
Until they want to build it.
Yeah.
Mike, you have a funny thing here on NJS Engineering 175-23C-5. I'm wondering what you're missing. Preservation of natural, cultural, historic, and scenic resources.
Oh.
You know what I'm talking about?
The 8 criteria going through there.
The letter conditional use application.
Yep.
On point 5, preservation of natural, cultural, historic, and scenic.
Yep.
Okay, look at the first dot.
Yep.
The second line goes except.
Hmm.
Except what? Except you're building a nuclear power plant. Yeah, that one tells
you. Yes. I don't see that. Maybe.
I mean, you can get back to us on that.
Yeah, I guess so. I don't see that on this one. Maybe there was something.
Which document are you looking at?
It says accept. It's the
conditional use?
Letter intent conditional use application.
Oh, and which criteria is
it? So can I work off?
Yeah.
Looks like you just dropped something.
Oh yeah, okay. Let me go back and look at that. Thank you. Yep.
Mike, will you have to go to the ZBA?
I don't think so.
No.
Madam Chair, it's after 10 o'clock.
I'm sorry, what?
After 10 o'clock, when we're supposed to.
No, that's only for new business.
That's my bedtime, yes.
No.
So isn't it 10:30 that you're not allowed to go past?
Oh, well, it's 10 o'clock for new business.
Okay.
So do you want to have a, I think this might be worthwhile for a site walk. Mainly, it is a lot line adjustment, but it almost functions like a two-lot subdivision because it's creating a new buildable area.
Yeah.
So I think it would be useful to see the existing driveway and,
yep,
you know, where they're going.
Yep.
Would this be treated any differently, Michael, if this was, if we decided this was a two-lot subdivision?
You'd probably treat it almost the same.
Because that's what it looks like.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, he has more, if it was a two-lot subdivision, he has a little more of a hurdle. But with a lot line adjustment, it's, he's going from two to two lots, so it's less of a hurdle.
Because it's a, going from a 2.1 acre lot to a 4.5 acre lot, so it's really not just, it's more than a lot line adjustment.
Yeah, yeah.
Anyway.
But it's a better lot, more buildable lot.
Yep.
But he has a right to that other lot, and he's improving it, so it's beneficial.
Okay.
All right, so
I'd like to make a motion that we set a public hearing on this project for
May 9.
Second.
5 o'clock?
No, he's making a motion for a public hearing. He made a motion.
Oh.
We haven't talked about a site walk.
Okay.
We want to do it, but we don't. We haven't set a time.
Well, you could go right after, on the same day, right after, it's on the opposite side of town.
We should approve the public hearing.
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, sorry.
It was seconded, right? You seconded.
You got it.
All in favor?
I'm sorry. I'm virtually asleep.
That's all right. Virtually.
How do you be virtually asleep?
Virtually asleep. Well, do you want to have a sidewalk? Do you want to do it like before or after the other one at 4?
I'd rather do it before, and I really have a good reason. It's because of Rufus.
Well, that's a good reason.
Rufus.
You can't bring Rufus?
Oh, I could bring Rufus, but then he'll need to be fed and everything before the planning board meeting, so I don't want to run into the...
So 3 o'clock? Is that good?
Or we could...
We could do 4 and 5.
Well, yeah, 3 o'clock.
But we already set the other one.
At 4. But I could tell the other fellow, you could set this anytime you want, and I can speak to Steve Riker and adjust it if need be. So you could set this at 3 or 4, and then we'll just have the other one right afterwards, you know, so I can tell them, be ready.
3 and 4:30? Maybe adjust the other one to 4:30?
Yeah, yeah, or even earlier.
That's all right.
I mean, we make it. It shouldn't
take
that.
I think we could do 1:03 and 1:04.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah,
it doesn't matter which one. Yep. We've already set one for 4, so set this one for 3.
Set this one for
3 o'clock. Yeah, and I'll tell him, you know, if he wouldn't mind.
Gives us a target to finish up.
Yeah. Yes.
Okay.
You check the forecast for that day yet?
It's going to be beautiful.
It's actually supposed to be hail that day, so just for
get the hail out of here.
I can't make it out of 3. I'll just run by one day, just down the road.
What?
I can't make it out of 3, but I'll just run by one day.
Oh, okay.
Not too far.
No, not.
Not far from you anyway.
Okay.
So we have a public hearing for May 9th and a site walk. So then that means that the application's accepted, obviously.
Oh, right? Yeah. So I'm assuming, yeah. Okay. Lot line, we probably, yeah, I'm assuming it's accepted as complete. Yeah.
Oh, did we have to vote on that?
That's all right.
We may as well. Yeah.
You already pushed on.
I think that's implied by sending public hearing. It's only a lot line adjustment.
Great.
Good.
All right. Thank you. I'll see you May 9th then.
So without taking much time, is what I put together for the UNH rezoning, is it okay if I bring something for that?
Give us a proposal.
Yeah, thank you.
Great.
Wow, that was quick.
That's the authority. When you've been out as long as Lauren, you can make these decrees.
Very good.
Oh, my. Are we done?
Oh, we have minutes.
No.
Yep.
But you can postpone them.
I want to postpone them. I didn't read them.
Yeah. They're very short. They're only a couple of pages.
I know. It's the shortest we've had.
I have one comment.
So, what's your comment?
Comment, page 4, under other business. There's a headline that says proposed appointment of planning board member to serve on the Durham Agriculture Commission, and then the minutes go on to talk about the Traffic Safety Committee and the traffic model.
Oh, yes.
I would propose that That title should go on the next page at line 42, but I would say it would be just as easy to just take it out completely.
Yep.
And that's my only comment. Anyone with anything else? Then I propose...
Line 24 on page 4, it said, in order to accurate predict, I think it should say accurately predict. The word accurate should be accurately. And on page 5, line 23 at the end, it says Council Lawson. I think it should say Counselor Lawson. And then on line 39 of page 6, Lauren Parnell moved to adjourn the meeting. Bob and Mr. Brown moved to adjourn past the
meeting. Both of you.
Bob and Mr.
Schizophrenic. Schizophrenic. You are.
Bob and Mr.
Brown.
Okay, we have a new board member.
The minutes of January 24th, 2018, as amended this evening.
Second.
All in favor?
Yes.
Aye.
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Now, do I have to do this?
Yep.